It's the Jay Thomas Best of Regurgitation Show.
How did you grow up not being trailer trash?
Because people from Louisiana and a lot of people from the South, the trash is not far from the nice neighborhoods.
I'm just saying, I can't believe you escaped it.
We're all the same. Like, when you see James Carville.
So you're right? Trash?
No, but you can be, because there's something in the South that is very close to what people consider low rent. It's one of the reasons why low rent white people hate blacks so much in the South. One of the reasons that they hate them is that they were considered white trash, right? And so they would work for somebody and they would be looked down upon or whatever. And they always wanted to have somebody to look down upon. And so if the black person became equal to them or better than them, then that group of individuals would have no one to look down on. Mm-hmm. And so they would be incensed if you said that a black person was equal to them.
Okay.
Now, they always go, hey, what about Boston? And what about, yeah, that all happened there too. And look at the individuals that didn't want black people to have equality. Look at them. Go to South Boston and meet some of those people. And you'll see what that's all about. That's the white trash revolt right there. Now, us, we could act like white trash, but we're all college educated and everything else. And if you're equal to us, you're equal to us, or better, or whatever the hell it is. That's why intellectuals sometimes are fighting for, you know, against discrimination. Does this not make, now this is actual sociology 101. It really is.
Hmm.
That when you look at people that hate other people because of their skin color or being Hispanic or whatever it is, look at what they think of themselves.
Right. Right.
Now, me, I discriminate against people that are doing better than I am.
I do that as well.
I want to tear them down. Mm-hmm. Blacks, Hispanics, you know, women, lesbians, gays, whatever, fine, as long as they don't go by me.
I usually don't go by a color or anything like that.
If you're white as the day is long, yeah. I don't like you if you're better than me. I'm against you.
You don't like anybody who's better than you.
No! And why should I? Screw them for being better than me.
Well, you obviously don't like yourself.
I'm not better than myself.
You don't like yourself.
I love myself. I'd only dislike myself if I one day woke up and realized I was better than who I thought I was. Then I would hate myself.
What?
That's exactly right. You know exactly what I'm saying.
This show is ridiculous.
Charles of North Carolina, thank God, or you would have no place to go. Yes,
hey,
Charles.
Hey.
'Cause only ridiculous people are on this show. So congratulations,
true.
Missy.
True.
Yes, Charles in North Carolina. How are you? Sorry to hear that outburst.
Who am I talking to?
I'm Jay Thomas. Jay Thomas.
Hey,
yes.
Hey, man, that interview was great.
Thank you.
Oh, man, I'm riding down here. I got a good heart on, man.
Aww.
From that Mary. Yeah, these other guys, Garrett and Sean, they felt nothing. She's there talking about it out of a textbook. That, to me, was hot, to me.
I have the internet where I could watch anything I want.
Excuse me. It's much more meaningful to someone like Charles and myself when in your mind you have this incredible image of a live woman, by the way, who is acting like she's... Yeah,
her name is Mary
Roach. All I was thinking about was Madison.
Bonk. Oh, you were thinking about Madison the whole time?
Oh, yeah. And when she said she was a little wet, man. Ooh.
Now here's the deal. She has never had... never had an orgasm having intercourse.
Never, ever.
Man,
and trust me, I've had a lot.
Out on that.
Would you?
You'd work that over, would you?
Yeah.
Nah, thanks, but it's not going to happen.
And anyway, when's your show come on, Madison?
You know, it's on. It's just on. You
so
know,
when's Alt Nation
on? Just, it's on. Just don't worry about it.
What do you mean it's on?
Just go.
He wants to know when to listen.
Just go to the website.
Alt Nation 22.
21.
First wave 22.
You know what? When I'm done here, I'll be there.
Okay.
All,
soon as she's finished here,
yeah.
She'll
21 Sirius XM 47. First wave, I'm on 9A to 3P.
Okay.
That's 22 Sirius XM 44.
Did you load up on pills before you came to work today?
No, I'm just... I'm having a real bad day today.
I wanted to hear a show.
Okay. Thank you, Charles. Hey, let me ask you a question.
Oh, you're talking to me or him?
I'm talking to you. Thank you, Charles. I'm going to ask you a question.
You know, I know you, you've...
I'm going to ask you a question, and I mean this.
Me for having, putting my personal feelings aside, but I wasn't in a J. Thomas mentality today until I got the call to fill in, so no.
Oh, you had to get ready. So the reason why, I see.
I was in a very...
So you need 24 hours before you can live up to what I want.
I'm in a very emotional, suicidal state.
How do you bring that, how do you bring them? If my wife and I shot at each other 10 minutes before the show, and we threatened to kill each other, and she was, I would go like this. Soon as I'm off the air, I'm going to deal with your ass.
I'm trying, but I have a little bit gas and
gas.
I tried to go to the bathroom, but some girl was in there, and
but that's not the problem.
I have a stomach ache, and I'm very sad. I'm just very sad today. I'm just sad. It's okay.
People are listening. They don't want sad.
Oh,
what
watch,
they want
the phones
is,
are lighting up.
Yes, I know. But you know what they want? They want to they're sad.
No,
they're
they want to relate to somebody who's famous, like me, on the radio.
Well,
who,
first of all, we're not famous.
Shut up. They want to be able to relate to someone, and I'm real.
You sound like you're on lithium or something.
I'm not on anything. I've been working out. I've been eating well.
In fact, if you keep talking like this, I'm getting a little...
Are you getting hard?
I'm getting hard right now, yeah.
I'm
apparently, any woman that talks to me today, and if she reads a science book, apparently.
It's Passover in a couple hours.
By the way, I'm going to say this now, and I'm going to say it from the bottom of my heart.
Did you know that?
I think Jewish holidays are ridiculous.
Thank you.
And I don't know why you make a big deal out of them.
Uh-huh.
There are only Jews in New York and a couple in L.A. and some in the bigger cities. The rest of the country...
Passover, eat some matzah.
It's ridiculous. It's like saying, oh, by the way, you know...
That's not nice.
It's the truth.
This is a big holiday.
This is America.
This is big, and Yom Kippur is big, so I will talk about it.
When you start walking around and you declare your allegiance to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, then you'll be an American.
Jay!
Hey, Brian of North Carolina, 888-4102-102. Yes, Brian, how are you?
Good, how you doing, Jay?
Good, man, thanks.
Hey, man, talking about them pigs with the corkscrew, I had to share a story. When I was about 17 or 18, about 35 years ago, we had an old Super 8 movie of some pig plowing some broad, doggy style. It was the most incredible thing I ever saw in my life.
You mean the corkscrew penis was going into a human? Oh, my God.
Right. And if I hadn't watched it about 8 or 9 times in a row, it's etched in my mind to this day like I saw it last night. And this pig was the horniest damn thing I ever saw. It was tearing up this woman's back with his hoofs.
Aww.
And he ended up putting a burlap sack over her so it wouldn't hurt her anymore. And this thing just plowed the crap out of this broad. And there must have been about 15 or 16 of us. We were 17, 18 right out of high school. And it was incredible. Torrance, California is where I watched that. I'm originally from Southern California. So
here's the weird thing. Mary Roach just told us that the pig ejaculates for 15 minutes. Once it starts, it goes for 15 minutes. What's so odd is, and I've certainly seen these ridiculous bestiality things.
Sick.
What has got to happen to a human being that they think that it's okay to let an animal get on them?
Maybe
isn't
they were molested.
More than molested.
When they would
who were they molested by? Porky Pig? Who molested them?
Yes.
When they try to get this pig off this woman, it would just go back at it again.
I just hate that. I hate hearing about animal abuse. Like
the pig would go back at her.
Oh, yeah. The animal abuse. I think he was abusing her. I mean,
no,
but
an animal doesn't choose to do that. Come on.
This sounds like moose abuse, the woman's had.
No, that's terrible.
You know how Porky, by the way, you know it's sad. Porky Pig died a few years back. Do you know how he died?
No.
He died of trichinosis from biting his own fingernails.
What?
That's a Jewish little joke here.
You know what? Would you knock it off on this holy, holy day?
That's why you don't eat pork, because of...
Is that why they do it?
That's why they don't... Because
I got a Jewish wife, so I know all this crap. You know?
You have a Jewish wife? Are you going to go to Seder this weekend?
No, I don't do that.
Why not?
I'm not Jewish.
Well, but you go to support your wife.
No, I don't do that. I don't even go to church.
What did this Jewish woman find interesting about you?
You know what? After 18 years, I still haven't figured it out yet.
Yeah. So you came to her totally un-Jewish, even un-Christian and everything else, and she just fell for you?
Well, it took a while.
Took her a while?
Yeah.
So you chased her and chased her, and you got her, and now you don't care about her. You don't care about her now.
Oh, I love her to death, but I just...
Well, you're not going to the Seder with her.
Well, she doesn't go either.
Oh.
Oh.
I'm not going to my family's.
See?
Oh, all right. Well, I'm going.
But I'm not speaking to mine.
Anyway, I just wanted to share a story with you. You guys have a good day.
All right. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. Fred.
You're going to a Seder?
I go every year.
Oh, with the lesbians?
No, not this year with the lesbians. I go to these people whose father died and left them millions and millions of dollars.
You're going tonight or tomorrow?
Saturday.
No.
Friday.
Seder is Wednesday, Thursday.
Whatever. Who knows? Friday night, I think.
No, Jay. There's no Seder Friday night.
I go when I'm told to go. I don't know what night.
Then it's probably tomorrow.
Whatever. This woman, the father died and left millions and millions of dollars, and he put this specific thing that they had to be Jewish, and that anybody that got his money...
I got one of those.
And he left the daughter in charge of all of the money.
Mm.
Her brother had become a Mooney, right?
Okay.
And the father had disowned him. And so he's a Mooney with a shaved head and the whole deal, and he's like a big deal in the Moonies. And so she felt badly for her brother, so every year the brother puts on like a wig or something and wears a coat and a tie, and he acts Jewish for the night,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And she gives him some money.
Good,
so
nice.
Everybody that comes are these Jews that want to get money from this woman.
Oy.
So I say to my wife every year, why doesn't she give us some money? And my wife goes, that's not why we're here.
What's the matter with you? Why would she give you money?
We're more Jewish than her friggin' relatives. We're actually there for nothing. Anyway. And, you know, you got to eat the bitter root. What is that?
Bitter herb.
You put that on the table. You got to eat the bitter herb.
Now, I was invited to an Orthodox Seder, but I can't go because I have them.
That's when all the food is cooked in a felt hat, isn't it? Isn't that correct?
You're an idiot.
They get one of those hats.
You really are an idiot.
And they boil the hat, and they put a potato in it.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How'd you That's know?
It. Isn't that when all of the Hasidic Jews lift one arm and you have to sniff under there?
Yes.
Fred of Scranton. You know why I could say these things?
Why?
Because 99% of the people listening will never go anywhere near a Seder.
Yeah, because and now
have
you're
no idea if that'll
be,
ever happen.
You're making them more anti-Semitic than they already are.
You know something?
By being a role model, you should
when
be more.
Everyone stops religion. We'll all be the same.
I agree. I do.
I have a cocktail.
Fred,
do I
Scranton.
Sound? Do I really sound
oh,
like
God, you said, Fred, doesn't you sound loaded? Fred?
I do have the cure for depression.
I'm not loaded.
What is it, Fred?
Well, Madison, go on the computer, go on to Amazon.com.
Yeah.
It's the best price on them. Get a Hitachi magic wand with all the attachments. It's going to run you about $55 with second day shipping.
Okay.
Then, I mean, this thing, you can break fucking concrete with this thing. It's like a jacket.
I will, because let me tell you something. The one I got right now, one use, and it needs new batteries.
Oh, no.
Well, no. This one plugs in. I mean, you have to have 110 volts of power. It's got a 6-foot cord.
Is this a real vibrator, or is it like a lawnmower?
What's it called?
It's the Hitachi Magic Wand.
Yeah, that's the most famous one.
Well, why don't you buy it for me?
You plug it in? Oh, you know what I love? You sound like you're in a bar and you went, why'd you just buy it for me?
I have my bedroom hooked up. I mean, I got the full rig out.
So you plug it in, and you bring that thing over to the bed, and it's buzzing and humming. And what are these attachments? Where do the attachments
go? Well, there's the curved one that's the G-spot. There's the straight one. And then there's another one that looks like a swan.
Wow.
And then what you want to do, Madison, is there's plenty of delivery services in New York City. Get yourself about 3 grams of good New York City sour diesel.
What?
Smoke the sour diesel.
Oh, yeah.
Sour what?
I guess that's
pot. New York City sour diesel.
That's pot?
Oh, it's beyond pot. It's pot square.
I live in a pot building. Everywhere I go in my building, I smell pot. In the elevator, in the bathroom, there's pot, 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 pot.
Fred, are you on oxygen? Because you're really breathing, you know,
I'm just getting over laryngitis.
Oh, I see. Okay. It's not like you're on an oxygen. I'm envisioning the shut-in with an oxygen tank, you know, making up all these stories about.
I have the stiletto. I had the headphones on. I was just running the bathroom.
I like his voice. It's kind of sexy.
Yeah.
I like his voice. Kind of sexy.
Fred of Scranton, thank you very much. Nothing sexier than Fred of Scranton.
Hey, speaking of pot, my neighbor comes over the other night. The guy lives downstairs. And I tiptoe around. I'm very courteous. I don't wear shoes in the house. He comes over. He starts in with me. He's like, what are you doing? You moving tables? You moving chairs? I'm like, I'm really sorry. I said, I'm not wearing shoes. I said, I'm sorry. I said, but I got to be honest with you, Bill. I said, you're really loud. I hear you partying all the time. And he starts in with me, and he's in my face. He's in my face.
Really?
And then this is what I threw at him. I said, listen, I said, I smell pot at all hours of the day. If I smell it again, I will tell on you.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's fabulous.
He got in my face, Garrett. He got in my face. He's like, you clomping around. I said, I don't have shoes on. I did not have
shoes. Do you have a rug in your apartment?
He was like, you better get a rug. He was nasty.
So I'm thinking the same thing.
I have quite a few rugs.
So it'll be quiet for a moment and then clunk, 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 clunk.
No, there's no clunking whatsoever. I never wear my shoes in the house. I'm extremely courteous. My TV is never on loud. Not loud at all. He parties at all hours. I hear him. I hear it coming up through the floor. He was pounding on the ceiling the other day and he came up and he started, he's like, I can't sleep. He doesn't go to bed till 3 a.m. He was in his full clothes.
You need to call the police.
Oh, so I told him. I said, I got to be honest with you. I said, I've kept my mouth shut for about a year, but you're very, very loud. Oh, I've been away for 6 weeks. I said, well, I said, you're really loud. I said, I'm sorry if I was loud, but as you can see, I'm not wearing shoes. And he said, well, I heard something, and I'm trying to sleep. And that's when I said, well, I smell pot. And he said, that's not me. And then as he was
leaving. Are you telling the same story again? I think we heard this already.
I'm just trying to tell it again.
Are you like an illusion? Of some sort? I don't know. Grant of Alabama, thank you for calling the Jay Thomas Show.
But I did. I threatened him, and he got scared because he walked. He walked. He just walked away after that.
Hey, what's going on, Jay? How you doing?
In a few minutes, we'll have a guy on who's invented the Unemployment Olympics. That's how bad it's getting. He's in New York, and you can join in the Unemployment Olympics in a few moments. Yes, Grant of Alabama, go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to tell you that Benicio Del Toro was in that movie Snatch. Yeah, afraid to carry that guy, Freddy Fourfinger.
Yeah. I guess I watched it after he must have been killed early on, right?
Yeah, he was killed. He got trapped in the back of the van when there was three black guys in the car.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that was him in the van.
Oh, you know what? That's almost every time when I turn it on, that's what I see is the dog. Now, when they hit Brad Pitt, and when he elevates in that prize fight, that is the greatest shot in the world when he is in midair like that.
Oh, yeah.
Before he hits the ground. That is incredible. You know, I don't know what that movie is about. I haven't the faintest idea. There's like a big diamond, an 84 carat diamond and all, but I like that movie, but I have no idea what I'm watching. You know?
I've never seen it.
It's interesting.
I'm going in circles, but it is a good movie, and Brad Pitt, I like the character he plays in it.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Grant of Alabama. Benicio Del Toro, who I'm sure is a good guy and a good actor, but I don't know why he works so damn much, and he's going to play one of the
three.
And
why did he do that for cocked movie Che? But he saw it.
Because every one and two, by the way. Because everybody
one
thinks.
One and two people saw it?
No, one and two. There was a Che 1 and a Che 2.
Right.
So
you had to go and watch
rent it.
And
right, yeah.
Get popcorn.
Go the next day. Yeah, hold it. Hold it.
Go the next day.
Here's the weirdest thing. Is that he's, works all the time, and they love this Che Guevara. And they have the T-shirts.
Why? Wasn't he a communist?
Not only a communist, he was, he was Castro's right-hand man.
Yeah, I don't understand
murderer,
why people
all of
like
this
it.
Stuff. Now, the CIA killed him and all of that's true, but he was just he's like Hugo Chavez, for God's sake.
I don't care.
Completely
I'm
going to
start wearing, that should be our new J. Thomas T-shirt. A picture of Hugo Chavez.
No, you don't.
And it'll say, the bubble will come out of his mouth. It'll say, I love the Jay Thomas Show. XOXO, Hugo Chavez.
How about this one? How about a picture of Che Guevara?
Yeah.
And underneath, I'm a murderer.
Yeah, that's okay.
Okay? Huh?
I think mine's better.
He didn't do anything. And you know what?
How about a picture of Osama bin Laden and in his beard, a bubble comes out and says, I love Jay Thomas.
Out of his beard? Out of Osama bin Laden's beard. That's what it would say?
A little man. Or no.
Wait a minute.
His beard could be your headshot.
I only come out of my cave for the J. Thomas.
Oh, my God, it's brilliant.
That's exactly. Sean, Sean, I only come out of my cave for the Jay Thomas show.
Oh, my God.
I don't like to brag about myself, but that's a good one.
Wait a minute.
I only come out of my cave for Sirius XM.
I helped you write that.
You're listening to the Regurgitation Jay Thomas. Yes.
He's the afternoon guy.
Very perks, not like the rest of us.
The Jay Thomas Show. On Indie, Sirius XM 104.
It's a sorry out to lunch version of the Jay Thomas Show. JayThomas.com, where the brand new t-shirt is Barack Obama, the new Mr. Goodrich, also my carbon footprint bigger than your carbon footprint, all of that stuff. And what an exciting day for the Jay Thomas Show. A man that had been a guest on our show, someone I've known for a long time, admired, actually went over to Caroline's and saw him one night and paid the cover charge and everything, just like a normal person. Kevin Meaney is here with us today. There you go. In the house.
Thank
there
you very much. I feel like I'm at the ballpark.
Now, Kevin Meaney, comedian, and the thing that he did years ago when I lived in Hollywood, there was a giant sign right outside of my home as I drove down to the bottom of the hill. It said, watch Uncle Buck, Tuesday nights or whatever. It was on CBS, wasn't it?
CBS.
You were Uncle Buck after the show came out with the Big Fat Dead comedian. They hired you. Sometimes I don't remember people's names, and what I have to do is say, and he was a friend of mine, I forget his name.
John Candy.
That's right.
Yeah.
But when I say Big Fat Dead comic.
Well, he wasn't dead at the time. He was alive and well.
We knew he was going to die, though.
Well, maybe you knew he was going to die.
You know who's a friend of mine? It's John Goodman. And I look at him all the time and I think, how much longer?
Do you say that about me?
No,
how
you're
many
not
people
big.
Do you say that about?
Well, you know what's funny about this show? I know Tim Allen listens, because I've done those Santa Claus movies with him, and so he proved it to me by taking you into the trailer and showing you his equipment, and then complaining about the signal to me, as if I was going to come back and fix it. Remember that, Sean? Tim Allen complained about the signal, and then in his comedy act, he actually did a thing, like whatever. So we know that, but we don't know who else listens, and apparently nobody famous enough to hurt us is listening. So you can... This is a chance for you to vent.
Well, a lot of people I know listen to this program. You know, a lot of famous people.
No, they don't.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. George Wendt.
That's true.
Yeah, he listens
I know
to
that.
This program.
We don't say anything.
He's a friend of mine.
Even though George is a little overweight, he's carried it so long so well, I don't think anything will happen to George.
So you're not predicting that he's going to...
No.
Die. Okay.
I think George lives to be 97.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm thinking.
But it seems to me that you know, you seem to be predicting that a lot of people are going to be dying just because maybe they carry a little extra weight.
Well, you know, I have to blame... You know, here's the thing. I want to live longer than everyone else. And many people that listen to the show on a daily basis know the immense selfishness that I have.
And you have lived longer than a lot of people.
I have. Here's the thing. When someone dies, like Ron Silver died.
God, that was tragic. You know,
62 years old.
Right? Your age. Hello? Is he still on the air?
We don't talk about any ages here, and I am not 62, and I'm not going to get in this big argument with you.
All right, but you are in your 60s.
No, I'm not.
All right.
And I want you to stop that.
Okay. I thought you were 10 years older than me.
No, I'm not.
I'm 52.
We were born the same week, you and I, walk from each other. So here's when someone passes away like that, or you see somebody, you know, in that, and I'd met him a couple of times. He worked at Sirius for a short time. Now, of course, he went totally to the right and became like Dennis Miller, right? So when those people pass away, you know, we're sad, but we're not as sad. You know what I'm saying?
Just because they don't share your political views?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Now,
so
do you not
Dennis
wish...
Miller, Dennis Miller met his demise, you wouldn't have a problem with that. You wouldn't be as sad as if he...
I would go to his funeral because we live in the same community, Dennis and I, but just to make sure he was really dead.
Yeah.
Okay. Just to walk by and go, okay, now I believe it.
Well, that is fantastic.
Unbelievable.
I
don't know why we brought this up. This is not what we're... You know what? We're here to make people happy. And we're here. This is now. I want to focus a little bit on you, and I thought something like I was thinking, like, my name, which is, really John Thomas, and I switch it to J, and then I have this horrifying, you know, Italian name behind it. So, and because John Thomas, it meant something. A Thomas person was, I believe they made muffins, or muffin makers. Then you had the Smith, and that's a person who would make, you know, a blacksmith or something like that. Then there's someone's last name would be Tinker, and they would be a person that worked on iron, or various last names. Now, your last name is Meany.
Yes.
And I was wondering if perhaps you had relatives that were mean.
No.
How would you get a name of Meany when different names mean things from way back when?
Well, that's the black Irish in me, the Meany.
The Meany, yeah. Right.
So not meaning that black people are... He's more mean than...
What does black Irish mean?
That means that I'm darker than your normal Irishman, you know?
Is that really what it means?
Yes.
I have
dark hair. I have dark features. I'm more of a Arab-looking than Irish-looking.
I don't... You're the less... You don't look Arab to me.
Well, I'm darker than your... You know, if you go to Ireland, you don't really see many people that look like me. You said they're very fair-skinned, freckles, red hair... they're very light, yeah. They look like they have skin cancer. You know, myself, I'm more, you know, I'm bronze when I go out in the sun. You know, I tan very nicely.
Was your group discriminated against in Ireland because of the dark hair and the stuff, you know?
Oh, yes. My family is still there. My father's family still lives in the same hut. That my father's mother grew up in, and her parents grew up in. They still live there, and they have like two rooms. And
no, they don't.
Yes,
no,
they do. No, I swear to God, I was.
Does it have a thatched roof?
It does have a thatched roof with a satellite dish on top. So it's very bizarre because they never had any money the whole time I grew up. We were always like, you know, after we were done with our clothes, my mother would say, "Give me those clothes. We're going to send them over to your relatives in Ireland." And we'd always have to pack up packages of clothes to send them because they had nothing. Now,
come on.
Absolutely serious. So now, you know, you go forward, you know, 30, 40 years, and now they're really extremely wealthy because they had all this land. And they waited until it was time to sell their land, and they sold it for big money. And now they still have their little hut that they live in, but they built a huge mansion that they right up on the hill.
These are your real relatives.
These
that
are
you
my
were
real
sending
relatives.
Little clothes
yep.
to. Now
Patty,
they're very
Patty
wealthy.
Patty and Eileen. Patty and Eileen.
Do they send you anything?
They never sent me a GD thing. You know.
You can. By the way, you don't have to go GD. You can say whatever you want to
I'm
say.
Not going
to
go there. Because that's
okay,
not me. That's disgusting.
It
no,
is.
But they. I went over there and I visited them a few years back when I did this comedy festival in Kilkenny. I think it was the Kilkenny.
Do you use an Irish accent when you go over there?
No, God. But you have to go up on stage and you have to drink. You know, if you don't go up on stage with a beer, you're a pussy. So, you know, and they're looking at me, he's a pussy. He doesn't even bring beer up on stage, you know.
Are you a drinker?
Oh, yes. I've had a couple before I got here just to loosen up.
We don't care. Yesterday, our co-host was apparently on some sort of pharmaceuticals, and we did the whole show with her, and we had to wake her up a couple of times. But what's great about satellite radio is however you come to the microphone,
yeah.
Sean Kelly, the executive producer, Sean, however you come to the microphone, we accept you, right?
Well, I was just at a farm party before we got here.
Yeah.
You know what a farm party is?
No, I don't.
No, you don't. Because you're old. You don't know what a farm party is.
No, I'm from the South, and a farm party is a whole different thing.
No, well, maybe that's not the farm party I went to.
Stop that pig from squealing, Bill.
The farm party
is
your...
That's the prettiest mule I got, Bob.
What the kids do today, they go to their parents' medicine cabinets, and they just take out all their pills.
Oh, pharmaceuticals.
And they don't even know what they are, and they just bring them to... You know, the party, and they just throw them out on the table, and they go, let's take them. And they just, like, start taking pills. They don't even know what they are. And that's called a farm party, and you get all messed up on that.
My kids, like, today, if they did that, they would throw up the package of Imodium out there, you know.
Yeah, from what you said before the show, absolutely.
Non-diuretic stuff.
Yeah.
Barney Frank is on line one. Kevin Meany is here. Yes, Barney, the Jay Thomas Show. Kevin Meany. By the way, in a few minutes, we'll talk to a guy who will tell us the weird and wonderful things and why we believe in superstitions and supernatural things. He has written a book called Super Sense, Why We Believe in the Unbelievable. Wouldn't you like to spend a long time with this fellow?
Yeah,
and,
I would.
Yeah, and so he's going to tell us about that. And he's not the only guest we have. We have a woman on that says people should start getting married at funeral homes. We'll have her on to talk about that.
I should have been married.
And a testicle festival. I always bring something for the co-host that I think that they'll enjoy.
Absolutely.
So the testicle.
Let's do the teabagging.
There you go. Barney Frank, yes, welcome to Jay Thomas. Your
this is Barney Frank. Is that guy going to be talking about Nancy Pelosi? Because she's unbelievable.
I don't know. Are you going to talk about Nancy Pelosi?
By the way, Jay, the golf channel's on hold, and if I wanted to hear about a ball getting stuck in a rough, I'd change over to Outkill.
You know what? Do we have the golf channel on hold again?
Barney Frank doesn't like it.
All right. Call him up, Barney Frank. Now, Kevin?
Yes.
This may not be the real Barney Frank.
No, I don't think it is. I know Barney Frank. And
yes, we've met many a time before.
Yeah. I remember I actually met you at a glory hole.
Oh, no, you didn't.
I believe I did.
Kevin Meany about 12 inches down there.
All right. You know what? I do not want to reduce this show to some sort of,
that's,
you know.
That's disgusting. I never met Barney Frank at a glory hole. But I have a letter from Barney Frank. When I was younger, I wrote to him. And
no, you didn't.
I did write to him, and I didn't know why. I don't know why I wrote to him, but I did. I was a concerned citizen, and he was my congressman up in Massachusetts when I lived up there.
Well, that makes sense, doesn't it?
And I did write to him, and he wrote me back, and he wanted to date me.
With my special stamp?
Mm-hmm.
What's your special stamp?
I shot a road on the bottom.
All right,
did
that's
you
it.
That, Kevin?
No. All right,
his
thank you very
staff?
Much. The stamp.
Stamp.
Thank you, Barney Frank. By the way, I wanted to say, get off. I wanted to say congratulations to the United States because these pirates have taken a ship, and it's been a long time since an American ship.
They are having a great season this year, the pirates. You know,
they are
2-1, and.
Right.
I, you know, not that I'm a big Pirates fan, but
they're doing great.
They are doing great. It's a great season for them so far. They have
screwed
Pirates.
They have screwed with the wrong country now, my friend.
No, I know what you're talking about, the Pirates.
Yes.
You know, this is the first time since 1804 that a U.S. ship has been hijacked by pirates. Did you know that, Jay?
You know what? We've had airplanes hijacked. We've had all kind of stuff. I did not know that was the date.
Yeah.
But that's a long, like Bluebeard or Jean Lafitte or one of those guys, right?
Decatur.
These pirates from Somalia have done German ships. They've done, you know, Libya has a lot of flags flying or whatever. They've done Swedish ships. But now they've fooled with the United States, and then the crew took the ship back.
You know, those Germans, they make great stuff.
And they have...
That's what the Sham Wild guy says, you know. So
they
you
have,
don't want to mess with that.
They have the captain of the ship, and they brought him ashore. And they have fooled...
Did they bring him ashore?
I don't think
they brought him ashore. I think he's out. He's still out in the dinghy. You know,
they have the poor guy in the dinghy?
They have him out in the dinghy, you know, away from the ship. But the people on the ship, they can sit... I believe it's called the Alabama. The ship's name is the Alabama.
It is the Alabama.
Yeah.
Yeah, wow. You really...
Maesk? Is it Maesk?
You're right. M-A-E-R-S-K.
Maersk.
Yeah. It's a line, and it's an American ship, and they went out and got it. I don't see how the little speedboats get up on the ship, but they know how to do it.
Perfectly. Yeah, I don't know how they get up. How do they do that?
Allowed to have a gun on board a ship. Any ship in the world, you can't have any guns.
Which is ridiculous.
Stupid. And you know, I'm not joking when I tell you, you're allowed to throw rotten tomatoes, and that's what they have on board. They have rotten tomatoes, and they have water guns, that's all, you know, like hoses. But they're not allowed to, and this was passed. Well, you know, we actually do, you probably can't call.
This is international law.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
You can't have a weapon. They're going to change that soon. And the weird thing is as the speedboat is heading for the ship, and I said this the other day, why don't we strafe the damn thing, you know? Call a jet in or call whatever in and just, you know, mow them down. They say they can't do it because it's a speedboat doesn't mean it's going to, like, do anything.
You actually have to go on board. You have to get on that ship, that boat,
right.
And you have to ask them for their paperwork. That is what international law says that you have to do before you know, otherwise you just can't shoot at them. You have to board their vessel and ask them for their paperwork. And these Somalians,
you have to ask the pirates for their paperwork.
Yes, you do. Because you can't assume that they're pirates. You know, I mean, they don't have a patch on their eye. And
sure they do.
They don't have a kerchief on their head.
Sure they do.
You know,
parrot on their shoulder.
Teeth, parrot on their shoulder. They're, I'm a Somalian. They don't even talk like that.
But wait a minute. You know? Wait a second. And if they sometimes have winches with them. You know, they always have those kind of sexy women.
Oh, those,
you know,
dirty, dirty winches.
Those dirty girl, dirty winches, right?
Yeah.
And so you have to board the pirate ship, the boat, and establish that they're pirates, first of all, before you can do anything. It's stupid.
Yeah.
Dumb. I think this is a war we can win, though. Because what we can't win is we can't win a war when we don't, when the uniforms get all mixed up. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, and every president wants a war. You know, it's not that they want a war, but they, you know, they get involved. You know, like Clinton had his war, Reagan had his war, which was in the Falklands, right? The mm-hmm. Falkland Islands.
That's right.
The Falkland Islands.
That's right. He also sent troops to.
Did I say the Falkland Islands?
You did.
Yeah.
Falkland.
Oh, but Falkland. Islands.
No, no, we didn't send
troops. Jane and Washington.
No, the British sent that.
Yeah, Falkland Islands.
We sent troops to Grenada.
Grenada.
And we saved medical students mm-hmm. who could not get into American medical schools.
Yes.
Because the Cubans were there.
Didn't Clint Eastwood win that war?
It was won so fast. It was like 2 or 3 days.
Yeah.
People were killed. Barack Obama has said he has an intense interest in the security of navigation.
Yeah.
That's what he said. That was his statement. That's a weak statement
and,
as far as...
And he's going to win this war, you know?
I think... No, you know, to me, you go down there, you strafe them, you know, you shoot them, and you just ask questions later. That's what pisses me off.
Yeah.
So they've got this guy. So that's what's. So I would love to see a fiery response from the United States, and I hope they do it. But I didn't know it was 1804. That is unbelievable.
That's the last time a U.S. ship, and I don't know what ship
taken.
That was. You know, that was
no,
taken.
That was when what's his name? Thomas Jefferson was the friggin' president.
Yeah, you got that right.
Unbelievable. By the way, before we go any further, Kevin, are you appearing anywhere this weekend that we can talk about? Or
talk? No, but next weekend I'm going to be in Rochester, New York at a club called The Comedy Club. You know, they really thought about this name.
Mm-hmm.
They said, let's call it The Comedy Club. And then the following week I'm going to be in Detroit at the Center for the Performing Arts.
Sounds like a big deal.
Yeah, that's a big deal. It's for Forgotten Harvest.
Well, no one lives in Detroit anymore. So, do you have, you know, I mean, they, you know, it's supposed to be like deserted there now.
Well, it is deserted. And people will be coming in from, you know, different parts of the country to come see the show. But nobody from Detroit will be there.
Now, are you going to give, is it to raise money for food? Is it some sort of harvest thing?
Raise money for people that are hungry.
Great.
Yeah. No, for the homeless.
You know, I'm not, I mean, you don't know much about me, but I'm a conservative a Democrat. I'm not big on the homeless. I read a thing today that in Honolulu, they have wanted to start they want to send the homeless back to the mainland. Because what they're saying is, and this is the truth, the homeless love the beach.
Yeah.
And they'll go to Santa Monica, they'll go Santa Barbara, where I'm, they go to Florida, and apparently they went over to Hawaii, and they're not Hawaiians.
How did they get to Hawaii?
I don't know. Isn't that weird?
Did they become homeless in Hawaii?
They probably did. They went over there for a vacation, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And they just stayed. And the state lawmakers want to fly them back one way.
Of course.
To that's right.
They're not going to fly them back first class or business class.
To reunite them with their families. That's mm-hmm. what they're saying. And I say, you know, to me, and when they build a homeless shelter, don't build it anywhere near where you pick them up. Take them out in the friggin' desert. Put them in the desert. I don't, you know, you live in New York. Don't you walk by the homeless all the time?
I work the Port Authority on nights mm-hmm. that I'm off. And, you know, you can make a lot of money.
Right.
You know, but no, I'm not in the home. I'm not out there doing that, you know.
I don't think you're doing it, but you see them when you walk down.
But I see the homeless by the Port Authority, and, mm-hmm. You know, they're And there's like a little shelter there where they go and eat, and
yeah,
you know, and there's another guy that, you know, I'll give change to occasionally.
Here, you know, here's my thing. A truck goes around at night, I've said this before, mm-hmm. and it shoots them with sleepy juice, you know, and you put them in the truck and you give them a little shot. And if you were to go there and not see so many homeless, no one's going to look for them. No one's going to ask about them. And I just think it's an interesting policy.
Jay, have you ever thought about taking a life insurance policy out on these people, too, before you give them the sleepy juice? You
know, that's been done.
I think I saw that on CSI or something or
mm-hmm.
somewhere. You know,
Here's what I think.
It's an insurance scam.
I want to go back to the Somalia thing. I'm thinking we send Black Hawk helicopters, but this time drop homeless on them.
Yeah.
Just drop the homeless on them.
We can have Jimmy Carter pilot the helicopters. Yeah, everybody, I'm going to try that Black Hawk helicopter thing again. I think I can do it this time.
Well, he told us on this show. Much. He told us when I first came on the air, we had him on, he had a book or something. He said that's what cost him the election, when the helicopters crashed into each other.
Yeah.
That was terrible.
No, that was terrible.
That was in Iran, right? Remember that? Then who sent I guess it was Clinton sent the Black Hawk helicopters into Somalia. That was terrible also.
Yeah.
You know what?
But, you know, nobody does a Jimmy Carter impression anymore, so I'm glad I was able to get that out.
You know what? I haven't heard one of those in a long time, and I'm glad.
You ever heard my Al Jolson?
No.
We don't want to hear showers, they come your way. That'd be great for Somalia. You know, this way, maybe send them some Al Jolson music.
Well, many people are saying, and I agree, and I've said this now, don't drop bombs. I wouldn't drop that CD exactly. Mm-hmm. But you drop jeans, you drop soda pop, you know, Coca-Cola, mm-hmm. You know, DVDs and all that stuff, and that's mm-hmm. that'll turn the world around. But strafing, I just don't know. And when you watched a war movie when you were a kid, whatever was trouble, the plane would go down. They didn't ask who they were killing. They just strafed.
Yeah.
Go right into friggin' Somalia, strafe the village. They know exactly where the pirates live. Exactly. It's like one little town. In all the movies, the British, when they wanted to blow, they just blew the whole damn town up.
Well, that's what the British did back, in the 1800s when they had all the pirate problems. The British went in and,
boom.
And they destroyed everybody.
Exactly. You know?
And they were against the slave trade, and so they went in and they freed all the slaves and mm-hmm.
and then leveled the town and
got rid of the pirates.
Exactly. And we can't do that anymore. And whether you're conservative or liberal or whatever, it's really stupid. And so they're going to keep. And they laugh at it. They take the boat out to the ship. They hijack the ship. We can't do a damn thing. And what's the use of having all the ships and the planes and everything else? For God's sakes, kill somebody. God forbid. We're over there in Iraq now giving out candy and nylons and chocolates again. No. No. Strafe. That's my new thing. Boy, that'd be a great name for a general, wouldn't it? General Strafe. General Jack Strafe. How are you? Welcome. Tim of Baltimore, The Jay Thomas Show. Kevin Meaney is here. 888-4102-102. Yes, Tim of Baltimore. How are you? Tim? Sean, are they still listening to the Golf Channel?
Sorry, I was listening to the Golf Channel. I was confused with Dan Patrick being on there.
We'll get that off a hold as soon as we can. I didn't even know we had a Golf Channel.
It was actually Dan Patrick who was talking about football.
Just for the Masters.
We have it for
live, yeah.
Well, you know what? Fabulous. So
there's nothing better than golf on the radio.
Well, we're not allowed to say anything like that. Apparently, if they made that decision, then it's a good idea.
Yeah, no, that's riveting. It's riveting radio.
Well, it will be.
He's lining up his putt, and he sees the cup, and he puts his putter to the ball. The ball is rolling and rolling, and ooh, it just missed the cup.
Golf's best word for hangout, the only whisper, so.
Yeah, that's right. You have to whisper.
You can watch it on TV when you have a hangover because they're only going to whisper. So,
it's good to watch when you have a hangover. See that?
Yeah.
You see, Kevin, our listeners always have a great idea.
He's a lefty, and he's up to the tee box.
Actually, two things. Since you're on golf, since golf is the best sport in the world,
mm-hmm.
because it's the only sport that a bunch of women can get together mm-hmm. on a nice day, play a nice round of golf, go back, have a couple drinks, maybe have a nice dinner, and then go back to the room and eat each other out.
Well, I'll tell you what, Kevin. You have brought a different type of listener to this show.
Did I say that? I didn't say that.
I like Kevin.
Yeah.
You didn't, but you're bringing people out. Your fans are calling.
Did I tell that man to say that these women go back to the room and eat each other out?
No, I don't even know.
My joke with golf is I shoot in the low 80s. If it gets any warmer, I don't play. Now that's a joke that I'll use. I won't go to the... Thank you.
Yeah, there you go.
But did I say back? But, you know, no. I think he's talking... I think what he's trying to say is that a lot of women golfers are lesbians.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm not trying to say that at all.
No, you're not. No. Well, they are.
Anyway, homeless... I only date homeless women because you can drop them off anywhere.
All right. You know what, Tim? Thank you very much. Send us where you're performing to jthomas.com. Kevin Meany is here.
I love it.
The Jay Thomas Show.
You have to humiliate for what?
It's fun.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoon. Sirius XM 104.
You're listening to the super spectacular Best of Show. JayThomas.com, our new t-shirt. Obama, the new Mr. Goodrich. That's available to you right there, okay? And KevinMeany.com, find out where Kevin will be performing. We also have My Daddy is a Trucker and the mess down there and all kind of other stuff. You can also email us at JayThomas.com or... Well, what a lovely lady Andrea was.
Oh, my God. She was, like, so much fun. I had a ball with her.
You were saying boner and everything else. And, you know, I never know how it's going to turn out.
Well, she was very receptive to that. You know, I could tell the minute we started talking to her that we were going to have a good rapport.
You could feel that.
I did. I felt it. I heard it in her voice. And I knew she wasn't afraid. And people that work in death have great senses of humor. You know, they really do.
I thought when you said boner that would be pretty much it for us.
No.
She absolutely loved it.
She laughed like a loon. You know?
Yeah, and you know, she started singing that little song. Yeah. And you started talking about the baby funeral.
The baby funerals,
and I thought, well, we're going to lose her now? No.
Yeah.
She was right there.
Because she has seen the baby, that little baby caskets. Oh, they're horrible.
You know what? God, I missed one. Has she ever made love in a coffin?
Oh,
God.
Well, that's where she would have been upset. Larry is, well, they're both 5'6", 5'7". You know, they would fit perfectly in a casket, you know.
She would have answered the question.
Yeah, she
God.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Don't you hate that when
I'm thinking
it's too late?
Yeah.
You know? Maybe she'll call back with a boner answer, Sean.
Yeah.
And if she does, put her right in here immediately. I will do it. Michelle Obama is on line one. Yes, Michelle.
Yeah. Baby, how you doing, baby? Okay.
Kevin, we don't know whether this is really Mrs. Obama or not. We don't know.
Mrs. Obama, it's a pleasure to meet you.
I'm a big fan of yours, Mr. Meany. Congratulations about coming out, baby. That's fantastic.
Hey, thank you, and my best to Malia and Kashi.
Yeah, that's right. Something like that.
Yeah.
I forget their fucking names, too, running around this bitch.
Those little dolls, and you got really mad when they made those dolls, didn't you?
I wasn't mad that they made the dolls, but they made them so fucking creepy, I just couldn't look at them.
They're like they had the Obama Chia Pet they had also.
Yeah,
well, that's why I'm calling, Jay. You know, did you hear about this guy at this Obama fried chicken restaurant?
Yes, I heard about that.
Brownsville, Brooklyn, Obama fried chicken restaurant.
Obama fried chicken.
Well, everybody's cashing in on the Obama name, so I said, well, fuck it, let's make a little money on the side, you know, stimulate the economy.
Right.
So I'm thinking maybe we come out with a couple things like, I don't know, what do you think it is? Barack's Beans and Franks.
All right. And what else?
Yeah. Muslim macaroni.
What's that?
Macaroni. She said macaroni.
Really?
Yeah.
Love the macaroni. What about, why is Garrett keep turning that fucking music up? I'm trying to talk over here, Garrett.
What about barbecue? You know, the barbecue sauce. What about sauce?
We'll see you later, Michelle. I'll be right back.
How about fish fries?
We're on break already. You could stop.
Oh, shit. Sorry, Garrett. Oh, fuck.
This is the Jay Thomas Show. It's our regurgitation. Best of.
Jesus Christ!
Jay's a real angry man, sitting in his angry land, spitting out his angry rants for nobody's.
What did that big chinned asshole do?
If he hates your point of view,
shut up!
He may just hang up on you. His venom will bring you to.
Talk show wife, of course, buys organic chicken breasts for $9 a pound.
Jay Thomas.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
I'm my own man. I'll run this mother the way I want to.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoons. The Jay Thomas Show. On Indie.
Sirius XM 104.
So this really smart woman with a really weird name, Mary Roach, comes on our show, writes this book called Bunk. Am I saying it right? Bonk?
Bonk.
Bonk. There you go. That's because it sounds like sex, right?
Boink.
Boink. Why don't you just call it like...
How do you spell that?
I don't know.
Come on.
Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you.
We had Mary Roach on before. Go to maryroach.net when she had the original hard copy of B-O-N-K. Now, Mary, how do you pronounce B-O-N-K?
Bonk.
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 That's Madison.
Mary, we went through this before with him.
Bonk. Bonk. Bonk.
What do you say?
Bonk.
He can't quite. He can't.
You're the guy who said bonk.
That's why I wanted you to remember me the rest of your life.
But
that's how
also,
I do it.
His K at the end is really quite grating.
No. It's, no.
Because you go bonk.
That's exactly
why?
I also say.
Why do you do that?
I say Atlanta, by the way. I don't say Atlanta.
Why do you say bunk?
Bunk. I'm doing Woody Allen.
Bonk.
Bonk.
Bonk. Bonk.
Oh. Bonk. Bonk.
Bonk. Bonk. Anyway, so Mary, now the first book sold and it's doing great. Now it's out there. You and your thing is it's a study of sexual physiology.
Yeah.
And how do you make it better? And the whole thing. And you did. You went all over the world during your research.
I was. I got around. Yeah, I was over in Cairo. I was in Denmark with some pig inseminators. I was over in London, embarrassing myself and my husband in a laboratory. I was all a few places in the U.S. I did do a fair amount of travel.
Now, what is your degree in?
I actually have a B.A. in psychology. That is, I'm a science writer who has to get herself up to speed and every new book, which is not something I recommend. I really wish I had a science background.
But now when people write books about all sorts of sexuality, and then you just act like it's some sort of science project, deep down inside, you've got to have some sick sexual thing going on. I mean, I'm sorry, but it's true.
You're the kind of guy that makes the sex researchers go, oh, please.
We don't need this research. We only read it to see how freaky people are. I mean, you and your husband had sex in an MRI machine. That's...
No,
that's
odd. It wasn't an MRI machine. It was an ultrasound, and that's even odder because I'll tell you why. In an MRI, at least you would have some privacy. In an ultrasound situation, the scanner is standing right.
You mean
there.
while your husband was entering you, there was a person there with that little device that would normally find a baby or a tumor or something?
Exactly. It wasn't my intent to actually be the subject, but he was having difficulty finding subjects, this researcher. And I did it because I knew, well, first of all, it would be a really fun thing to try to write up. And second, I didn't have any other way to answer people's curiosity, my curiosity and my readers' curiosity about what would that be like to be a subject in a sex research study? What would that, how do you do that? What does it feel like? What are you thinking? That kind of thing. So the best way to really answer those questions is to go and do it.
Do you remember the movie Taxi Driver?
Yes, De Niro and Jodie Foster.
Yes, but when De Niro takes Sybil Shepherd to the movies, do you remember the scene, Madison?
I do not remember that scene.
He took her to a porno, but it wasn't a normal porno. It was an X-ray vision of a penis going in a vagina.
No,
it was
I don't remember that.
It was like an X-ray of it, and it was you go. Yeah, rent that movie because there's a flash of what they're watching. And, of course, she's horrified by it. And it's this penis going in and out of a vagina.
Uh-huh.
And it was, I guess, under an X-ray.
Right. Yeah, right. Because you can film in moving footage of X-ray. And I've seen moving. I haven't seen that clip, but I've seen that technology. Yeah.
Right. So do you lie on your back? Do you get doggy style? Your husband enters you, and then there's a person with the wand. Where do they put it? On your ass? On your stomach? Where do they put it?
They put it on your belly because they need to be. You know, if I was like, you know, remember those visible women, the see-through woman? Okay,
yeah.
The only way you'd be able to really. You have to be looking through the front, you know, scanning through the front to be able to see anything. So we had to be kind of spoon style, I guess, is the way you, you know, we're lying down.
Now, did he need Viagra to keep it up under this?
Oh, you bet. Yeah, there's no way you could do this study.
No.
Yeah, okay, there was an MRI study about 10 years ago, and they had to shelve this project because none of the men could keep it up because the MRI at the time you had to hold still for a minute while everybody lost their erection. So they couldn't do that study until the invention of Viagra.
So B-O-N-K is the book. I mispronounced it apparently.
Bonk.
And it's bonk.
Bonk.
Bonk. So and so we read the book, and of course I'm going to focus on some other things. There's some pig screwing also, which is also exciting in the book. But
I want to hear about the vaginal weightlifting and the carrot addiction.
We're going to stay all there. But here's the deal. Your husband, see, I'm trying to put this into my life, right?
Yeah.
I have a wife, and let's say my wife is a research person like you, and she says, look, here's the Viagra, get hard. This woman over here is going to rub that jelly on my stomach, and we're going to watch your penis go inside of me. What do we learn by this?
Well, in this case, he was trying to figure out, would the technology even work? Could he even get an image? And it's pretty cool. It's 4D. Yeah, you know, in other words, it's three-dimensional, but it's through time, it's basically 3D moving picture. And wanted to find out, does it work, number one? And then number two, would it be, is this something that they could use in some sort of diagnostic way, say for painful cases of painful intercourse? And I agree. The answer is no. Nobody. You're better off with painful intercourse than you are.
Too bad it hurts. I'm not going to do it anymore. Is what you're going to really hear from somebody.
It's right? It was like the MRI. It was also just a case of let's see if we can learn. Let's see what we can see, and maybe we'll discover something interesting that nobody knew before. And the MRI stuff, they learned that the root of the penis is longer than they thought.
The root of the penis?
Yeah, there's like more of the penis inside the body than there is hanging down.
How do you get that out of there?
Yeah,
can you pull on it? Because I've been pulling on mine for years, and it just, nothing's happened.
Well, go ahead and you can go ahead and add about 4 inches to the length of your penis to just tell people. And all that,
you'd have
all
to go inside to get that.
Yeah,
you know what? Why aren't women rated by the size of their vagina? You know,
you're right.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but then would it be by how tight it is or how big it is? I mean, a big vagina isn't usually thought of as a appealing quality.
It's not even a discussion.
What a double standard.
There's big tits, there's a great ass,
okay,
and there's a penis. Oh, his penis is big, his penis is small.
Okay, excuse me, women are judged on their tits, right?
Yeah they are.
There you go.
They are. I happen not to be a tit guy.
Well, I like that.
I find
I'm a small titted woman, and so I like that.
I find guys that are into big tits to be insecure. And I also find women that don't have big tits have been so mentally maimed by men that I can manipulate them because that's all I want to do is manipulate.
You're like my friend Clark who decided he wanted to date this woman who had one leg because he thought she's beautiful and other people won't want to go out with her, so maybe I could get her.
It's
I'm
true.
Like, Clark, God.
You know what? Why do women... You know what's so funny? We'll come back and talk about it. Why... Every guy listening now is going, that sounds right to me. Why doesn't it sound right to you? I don't understand that. And to you too, Madison. Why doesn't that make sense?
Why?
What?
That other guys aren't going to want this beautiful woman because she's missing a limb.
I know a guy who likes to have sex with one-limbed women simply because he's a freak, not because of that.
All right. It's the Jay Thomas Show. Mary Roach is here. Bunk is the book. Sex psychology. You women. Women. Men. You women, you men. You women. Well, as Mary continues talking, my bunk gets harder.
Jay Thomas.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoons.
The Jay Thomas Show.
The show that the average listener would do if they could do their own radio show.
Sirius XM 104.
Well, many of you love two things. Bestiality and bacon. The Jay Thomas Show. Madison is here. And listen for her on Alt Nation. Mary Roach is here. Go to maryroach.net. Bunk is the book. And now, what does the term B-O-N-K mean? Why did you name the book something that's hard to pronounce?
Do you find bonk hard to pronounce?
No, it's something.
I told you this before. You don't remember it. But when I was on sitcoms, they were looking for words, and every show would use them to denote sexual intercourse.
Yeah.
And one of the ones,
you know what it is. Why'd you ask her?
Boink was what they used on sitcoms.
Well, there is boink and there's bonk, but I tell you why I didn't use boink. Because boink is so, to me, it's like a cartoony word.
Stupid.
Boink?
Stupid.
Boink, it sounds like when somebody's eyeball pops out and bounces across the floor. Remember in Don Martin, Mad Magazine?
Yes.
Okay. Boink, that's a boink sound. Bonk is like, bonk.
We'd have to say boink on a TV show. Like a guy would come in and he had a date last night, and then you had this line. Well, did you boink her? And I mean, oh, my God. We'd have to, you know, good thing they were paying us a bunch of money.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
It was really dumb.
Bonk. So bonk sounds more like sex. Bonk, don't you think? Bonk.
No, I don't.
It does. Bonk.
I like the book. What I don't get is why do we need to know, and this is from your book, if a dead man can get an erection or not?
Well, I can give you the scientific answer, or I can give you my answer, which is because it's kind of cool to know that, wow, and I have the DVD. I could show it to you. It's pretty extraordinary.
Of a dead person with an erection.
Well, yeah. It's a different kind of... Do you want me to explain it to you?
Well, I think I have the mental image of it.
Okay,
there's a cadaver. There's a bloodless cadaver. A cold, bloodless...
Yes.
You know, like rock hard rigor mortis cadaver, and then his penis is sticking straight up in the air. Now that I have that information and that horrifying image in my head, what do you add to it after I read the book?
All right. Well, here's what was going on.
You don't mind being challenged, do you?
Not at all. No. I enjoy it.
That's what I'm here for.
There was a study. Okay, it's a surgeon who uses surgery to treat erectile dysfunction. And what he does is he ties off some of the veins that drain, the blood drains out of the penis, because if you keep the blood in there longer, you have an erection longer. He needed to find out which veins are the most important. So he had a series of cadavers, and he was tying off different veins, and then he put saline through the penis like the blood would go through, and then whoop, that guy got an erection. So it was in the course of this project. He wasn't just going, hey, let's see if a dead guy can get a boner. That was not his goal.
And so there are operations now because of this. But, you know, you do it in a sexy way. Can a dead man get an erection? You know what I'm saying? And then you make fun of me for liking that in the book.
But it's so fun to make fun of you.
It is.
Here's another one.
It's fulfilling.
You know, in these what is tantric sex? Isn't that where you sit with somebody for a long time?
That's what Sting does.
Sting is like, he's co-opted tantric sex.
And the wife sits on top of you. And how long do you sit there and what happens?
I've never had tantric sex. I did actually, there was a tantric sex research center in India, and I was very interested to go there, but they seemed to have disappeared and I couldn't find them. So I don't know that much about tantric. All I know, it's kind of has to do with energy flow, and it's more of a meditation practice. It's sex, but it's also kind of meditative, and it's about prolonging. I think it has to do with delaying and expanding orgasm. I'm just going off the top of my head.
Look, you know what? I have to tell you, I think sex is great and everything else, and I'm sure, you know, long, languishing, lovemaking is cool and everything else, but the best sex is when you make out a little bit, you rub a little bit, you bite a little bit, you lick a little bit.
You
both screw, she comes, you come, and then, the ball game's on. You know what I'm saying? And she gets to go and do what she wants
to
do.
Who has that kind of time to just, 12 hours?
But that's not what it's for. I don't think it was made by nature or God or whoever for all of this languishing and sitting and looking. And I mean, I just don't. I don't think that was the physical need of
no,
sex.
No, probably not. I mean, if you look in the animal kingdom, you're not seeing, except for pigs who take their time. The male pig orgasm takes 15 minutes. That's fairly tangible.
Is that why men are called pigs?
Probably.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, we heard yesterday they're using pigs and they're blowing them up. They put the armor on them. They strap them in a Humvee.
Oh.
Did you know this?
And
they blow the pig, they blow the Humvee up to see what it's like. And they said that a pig is the most like a human, the heart, the lungs.
Yeah, that's right. They do use pigs because their organ setup is very similar to humans, but they're not conscious at the time. They're either dead already, or they're anesthetized.
No, they're not. They can't be dead. They want the blood rushing through.
Anesthetized. They're anesthetized then.
That doesn't make it any better.
Now, and the other thing is, we're saying, it's even harder teaching the parallel park a Humvee.
And they don't have nearly, they can't, they've got cup holders, but the pig can't really hold the coffee cup.
Why does the pig take 15 minutes to do it? Does it pump for 15 minutes, or does it sniff around? Because they've got that nose, they love sniffing.
They love sniffing around. Yeah, no, pigs are big on scent. It's actually a 15-minute ejaculation. And it's so pure. Yeah.
God almighty, it just keeps gushing out of them?
Keeps coming out. If you're a artificial insemination technician, you have to have really strong hands, because you're like gripping onto that and holding the thing, the artificial urethra collector device.
You mean the juice just keeps coming and coming and coming?
It goes on and on and on. Yep.
Man,
I know.
Did you see that movie Snatch, that Guy Ritchie movie?
Yeah,
Snatch.
with Benicio del Toro.
Well, they talk about how pigs can eat human beings. No, Benicio del Toro's not in it.
Yeah,
Brad Pitt.
Yeah, I thought Benicio del Toro was in it, too.
Garrett, is Benicio del Toro? No, I think Brad Pitt's in it only as American star.
Brad Pitt's in it, yeah.
And then Dennis Farina's in it. But they say that a pig can eat a human arm, like when you chop an arm off trying to get rid of a body medicine.
You throw it in it, too.
And he must have been dead by the time I watched it. And they can eat it in 18 minutes. Paul of Alberta, the Jay Thomas Show. Is a pig's penis corkscrew scrape? Somebody's asking me that.
Yes, it is. And the vagina is also corkscrew shaped.
Oh, my God. Does it sound like a bottle, like a wine bottle opening? Garrett, do we have a penis, a pig pulling his penis out of a female penis? Yeah. Do we have that sound in our library? Let's hear it, please. We have it? Because I knew we were... There it is. All right. Paul of Alberta. Yes, Paul, the Jay Thomas Show. Mary Roach is here, who, you know, is pretending this is all about, you know, higher learning and all that. And it's just she's some sort of sex freak that has written a book, Bunk. Yes, go ahead, Paul.
Well, a couple things. One, tantric sex is about prolonging the male orgasm so a guy can have multiple orgasms.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Have you ever had a multiple? I mean, have you ever had more than one in like 10 minutes or something? Has that ever happened to you?
Well, actually, it's breathing techniques. I've done some studying on it and some practicing, and yeah, I've managed three orgasms within the one session.
Now, who sits on you? Who are you using for this?
Whoever I can get.
So the woman's willing to sit there, and you just look at each other. How does it work?
Well, no, I mean that's just part of it. I mean that's the yum, and that's just part of it. But anyway, what I wanted to ask Mary was, where's the video of the ultrasound sex?
Oh, my husband and I, that one.
Yeah.
That's
actually
on the internet. After?
It's on the internet. Yes, it is. In fact, it's on Slate. The Slate video site has it.
You mean I'm talking to you now, and I'm going to go on the internet, and I'm going to see a penis inside of someone that I'm actually talking to?
I'm
sorry.
Don't do it.
Oh, this is terrible.
Go ahead. It's the most G-rated, X-rated footage you'll ever see. You know what? It's also on Dr. Deng's website. If I could send you the URL, I don't have it in front of me.
But does it? What do we see on there? Is it you? Can we see sweet little Mary there with this throbbing penis inside of you? Oh my God!
It's like
watching my sister get screwed on the internet. It's terrible.
No, it's nothing like that. Have you seen footage of a fetus?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. It's like that. Instead of picturing the little tiny baby, you're picturing
your husband's little tiny penis. Well, that's nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it's 2 seconds. It's like, and it's done. You know, it's not.
Okay. Well, let's go to other things in this.
Anyway, it's on Slate Video somewhere.
Here's a big one that everyone's talking about: is vaginal orgasm a myth? Now, what does that mean, vaginal orgasm? Aren't they all vaginal orgasms?
Yeah, the problem is that people don't define. They could. Are you talking about a G spot orgasm, or are you talking about just straight on missionary position intercourse? I mean, there's a lot of definition that needs.
So, Madison, when you come,
that's never, ever, ever in my life has it been during intercourse ever.
Really?
It's always clitoral. Mm-hmm.
But see, a lot of times, I mean, if depending on the position you're in, you can involve the clitoris.
You need You need to start screwing pigs.
Okay.
You need a corkscrew penis.
I'll do it.
So I don't understand it. A man.
Thank you.
A man comes.
Ah!
And accept the fact that it's either in his hand,
or in a
watermelon,
got it easy, man.
Or in any sort of a piece of fruit or a handkerchief or whatever, or inside of a woman or a man or a whatever. But basically the sensation of coming is more exciting when you're in a human being, I'm sure. So is that it? Is it a sensation, or is it truly a different orgasm when the clitoris is rubbed? Doesn't the clitoris make you come when the penis is in you?
Well, it depends on the position. That's why women like to be on top, because then they can control the angle that they're at and the speed and the depth and everything, and that they can, if they want to stimulate the G-spot, which is on the front, you know, the belly side of the vagina, they can do that. If they want to kind of position themselves so that the clitoris is getting stimulated by some part of the male body, then they can do that. So that's I think that my impression is that's why women prefer.
Can I put you on hold for just 1 second?
Who, me? Yeah.
Yeah, put her on hold for 1 second. Garrett, let's go around the horn. You ready, Garrett? Go around the horn. Garrett, do you have a hard-on listening to this?
No.
Sean, do you get a hard-on listening to this?
No.
I have a hard-on.
Why don't you ask me?
Well, you don't have anything to get hard.
You don't know what's going on down there.
Do you have a wide-on listening to all this?
Maybe I have a wet-on.
Do you?
A little bit.
Okay, take it back. There you go. Mary was in a soundproof booth a few moments ago. I had no idea what we were saying. Okay, I'll tell you what I was saying, Mary.
I heard what you were saying. And you know what? Women do get hard-ons. Guess what? They do.
Nipples. Nipples.
Yeah.
I've told you 100 times. It's a soundproof telephone line. And this is the second day in a row, Sean, that someone has said they can hear what we're saying, which destroys the myth of going around the horn.
Just pretend they don't say anything, Jay, and continue on.
All right. So here we are talking about it, and it's weird because you're very, but if you and I were having a drink, and I know you're happily married and I'm happily married and all that crap, and you're talking about your book, by the time we're finished talking about it, I'm ready to jump on you and just tantric your ass.
Really? You know,
yes, I'm ready. That's the sick thing. As a man, I can't just have this discussion and act like it's some, you know, educational experience.
Wow, so there's people reading Bonk in the men's room, you know, getting then whacking off.
And I think deep down inside you know that, and I think that a lot of women say things to men like, "Oh, why is that what you're always thinking?" And yet deep down inside that's sort of what they're thinking too, but they say that crap to make us feel bad.
Oh, I don't know. Honestly, I never pictured anybody using Bonk the way they would use Penthouse. I didn't picture it. See, well, I was hearing around the horn, and you're the only one who's getting a hard on. So, I think it's you, Jay.
Maybe so. But I just, you know, it's an odd discussion to be having, you know, and you're an attractive woman. I'm not going to go online and look at you with your husband, because if I saw your husband, I'd kill him because I love you so much. I love you so much, I'm going to go.
I'm going to send you the link. I'm going to send it to you every day and force you to look at it.
Oh, my God. By the way, if I didn't have a heart on before, I do now. The word force you to look at it. How about Garrett? How about now, Garrett, after hearing that?
Definitely.
Yeah, there you go. Well, Mary, thank you, and good luck with this book.
this book.
And Madison had asked earlier a question. What did you want to know about from another one of Mary's books, Madison?
Vaginal weightlifting.
And carrot addiction.
Oh, yeah, vaginal weightlifting. You could probably combine the two in some way. But anyway.
Why would you want to weightlift with your vagina?
I can answer that.
Yeah, what's wrong with you, Mary?
Okay. Well, that's a whole other hour-long show. But the vaginal weightlifting, you know, Kegeling or Kegeling?
Oh, yeah, Kegel.
Sure.
Kegel, I'm doing it now.
To make it tighter.
You
know, I had one girlfriend. I had one girlfriend who used to practice that and stuff and went to yoga and all that. And one night, she did it to me,
yeah.
And I have never. It was like you were inside of her, yes. And there was a person inside of there, also pulling you.
Yeah.
So it was like having sex with two. And when I came, I never felt anything like it in my life.
No, and Kegeling is it makes women more orgasmic. So the weightlifting thing is like, well, if it's good to tone those muscles, then why not do some resistance training? So they have this little, it looks like a doorknob, a two-sided doorknob, and you put it in there and you go, and one, and two, and one, and two, and you lift this thing up, and it's pretty heavy.
Would it help Madison come, maybe, vaginally?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it would.
Can we buy one from you? Do you sell these?
I don't sell them, no. I don't know if they're still for sale. They're called. It's called the Feminine Personal Trainer.
Can you send me that link also?
Yeah, absolutely.
Can you use it for your butthole? Because I'd like to maybe tighten that up.
You sure can, Jay.
What all right. Yep. All right. There you go. Mary, thank you very much. Bonk, B-O-N-K is the book. Mary Roach, New York Times bestseller. Now it's out for, paperback. And if you go to maryroach.net, you'll see all the incredible places that she is book signing. Are you someplace tonight that people can go to? Or
Tomorrow I'm in Grass Valley. Next week I'm in Texas. Where are you? Where are you? You're Connecticut.
I'm in Santa Barbara. They're in New York.
All right, yeah. No, not on the paperback tour. Sorry.
Okay, all right, that's cool. Mary, thank you very much. Mary Roach.
Thanks so much. Bye, you guys.
Bye.
Thank you. Don't you think, Madison, though, seriously, if that's what you want to do for a living, that's the kind of book you want to write, don't you think deep down inside there's a sexual thing there? I mean it, even though it's supposedly scientific.
Probably.
I mean,
yeah.
Who would think of that? I mean, I would think of it.
A perv.
I would think of it, but I wouldn't have the guts to write it. I think of a lot of things, but I wouldn't have the guts to write it because I would know that people would know about me stuff that I want to stay private.
Right.
Like I would never write a true story about, you know, what I'm really thinking on a daily basis. Like people write these books, you know, and their novels. And
now, my parents would have heart attacked. There's just no way.
Even though you made it fiction, and there'd be, you know, thousands of people that don't know you. But when you read someone's novel, they're not making that up for the first time. That's, you know, they give a character some weird, you know, fetish in
a
novel.
Sure.
They're doing it.
Probably.
I'd have been a great writer.
You write what you know.
Exactly. Because the only thing I could write about a relationship would be the truth about my relationship, right? I mean, I could make some stuff
up. Unless you do all sorts of crazy research, you know.
God, who wants to do that?
Nobody.
You know.
You write what you know.
Goes around looking at corpses with hard-ons and...
Carrot addiction.
Now, by the way, I'm not joking about the Kegel muscle down there, and I'm not kidding. She worked, and what's sad is that she only did it to me right toward the end of our relationship.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, Madison, I never felt anything like that in my life. We were going along, all of a sudden she it was almost like, you know, like they say an athlete has two speeds, they're going fast, and all of a sudden they put it in another gear, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She put that thing in another gear.
Wow.
And it was like a little hand in there.
I'll have to try that.
It was like she had a little friend inside of her.
Right.
Oh, and, you know, I whoop and holler after I come.
Right.
I jump around the bed.
I had a guy once, he would go,
No, I leave the bed and go, oh, man, yeah!
That's hot.
Yeah.
I like that.
You know, the first time I got laid, I did that, and it pissed the woman off. And I liked her. But I was so excited that I got laid.
Right.
That when it happened, oh, my, oh, wow, like, God, I can't believe I just did this thing, you know?
Right.
Well, I've heard so much about it. Wow.
Oh, God.
Oh, I pissed her off. You know.
What did Gummy Mary say?
No, Gummy Mary didn't say anything. You know what? I'm too mad about you. That's enough about corkscrew wee-wee. All right. Hey, it's the Jay Thomas Show. This is our best of regurgitation.
Jay Thomas.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
I'm my own man. I'll run this mother the way I want to.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoons. The Jay Thomas Show.
On Indy. Sirius XM 104.
I'll take, well, I don't actually get the money now. I'll get it later. And then I'll smuggle cocaine for you, even though I'm from Atlanta and I've never been to Venezuela or Amsterdam before. That's right. And then I'll get on the National Geographic Channel. It's the Jay Thomas Show. Hey, David, welcome to the Jay Thomas Show. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing great. It's an honor to talk to you, Jay. A big fan.
Thank you so much. My friend Roddy Lee Conover is here. Garrett Andrews is a huge fan of the National Geographic Show, Locked Up Abroad, Caracas, and that'll be tomorrow night premiering at 10 o'clock, the new season. It's the third season of Locked Up. Now, you're out of jail now, but why don't you tell us what we're going to see on Wednesday night, because how did you get in jail in Venezuela?
Well, that's what you're going to see on the show tomorrow night, about how I was approached and how I was given every assurance that everything was safe, that everybody's bribed along the way. And
the drug dealer told you this? The drug dealer said it was all going to be fine? Okay.
Oh, yeah. Even if they call your name at the gate and they look through your bag, don't worry, we got a guy there, he's been paid, he'll look at your bag and say, okay, you're good to go, which indeed happened. And then another guard came over and said, wait a minute, those aerosol cans, you can't put those under the plane, they're flammable. And they ran them through the x-ray machine, and, well, that's where they figured out where the cocaine was hidden.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
So they offered you how much for carrying this stuff?
Well, you see, here's the funny thing, you know, having never done this before and never doing it again, they offered me $5,000. Now, when the embassy came, the first thing the guy said was, well, don't you know the going rate is $10,000? Of course, no, I don't know this.
So where were you when this guy met you? Were you living in Atlanta at the time?
Yeah, I was I'm a musician and, you know, struggling to make ends meet. I haven't had a real job since 2001. And I was doing pretty good, but you know, things were getting a little slim.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when he first approached me, you know, I thought, heck no. But, you know, the more I thought about it and the lower the bank account got, you know, the more I thought, you know, maybe this is safe. He said it's safe.
It wasn't a guy named Mark, was it?
No, No, why? You know,
because I know a coke dealer in Atlanta. I've known him for years, and I haven't talked to him in a long time. But a guy named Mark, I know from.
We're calling him Melvin on the show, but that's not his actual name.
But it isn't Mark, is it?
No, it's not Mark.
Okay, because you hesitated.
That was a quick disclaimer there, Jay.
Yeah. Well, no, I just wanted to say that.
You were pedaling backwards like.
So David Evans has this crazy idea. He wants to get on radio and television. So he takes $5,000, and he's going to deliver cocaine from Venezuela.
No, I didn't get the money. They were going to pay me when I delivered on the other end.
Well, of course you didn't get the money. You didn't make the delivery.
Yeah. You failed.
And why would you get paid?
Well, that's what he said.
Now, you're hanging around. Did they fly you from Atlanta to Venezuela to make the pickup, or you have the stuff with you when you get to Venezuela? How's it work?
I flew from Atlanta to Venezuela, and I stayed in a hotel room for about 7 days. They want you to, you know, stay several days so you don't look like you're just showing up to pick up drugs. You want to look like a tourist.
Okay.
And after 7 days, I get the phone call, and I meet the fella.
Is it Spanish guy? It's all Spanish accents?
No. These are all these were Americans that went down to arrange it, but they wanted a nice, pasty-faced gringo to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, less likely to get picked.
And there's no way you can get caught.
Well, that's what I was told.
Yeah. Now, did it ever occur to you that...
By the criminals.
Did it ever occur to you that if there's no way to get caught, they might save $5,000 and do it themselves?
Well, no. See, I'm sure they had records or something. They had reasons. They're always picking up new mules to make the run. Mm-hmm. Now, what it did cross my mind is that maybe I was set up with 3 kilos to get caught so that the guy behind me with 50 kilos doesn't.
Oh, my God. Do you think that happened?
Do you think he was carrying woolite and they really didn't know there was coke in there?
I don't know if this guy set me up or if he got set up. I don't know. I haven't seen high.
Well, did you turn the son of a bitch in is the question.
Boy, you know, he better...
Bad idea, huh?
Real soon, right?
Yeah.
What? No, but
bad idea.
Yeah.
It's a bad idea if you turn him in, right?
Oh, yeah. You kidding me?
Well...
You'd be like a stuck pig in about 10 seconds.
My path, right?
Yeah.
No, but I mean, you're not going to... So when they said if you turn him in, this is how it works. You know that. If you turn him in, then you time goes less on you, correct?
And you know what happens while he's in prison for his lesser sentence?
He gets killed.
He's cut from crotch to smile.
So they find... we're going to watch this on tomorrow night on National Geographic, Locked Up. Caracas. It sounds like a travel show, doesn't it? But the thing is they arrest you. Do you get an attorney? Because you don't have any money. You haven't been paid. You're broke anyway, right?
Yeah.
So who do you use for an attorney?
Well, you could pay, upwards of $10,000 to $20,000 to get an attorney, but they're not going to do anything. There's really not a trial. You go in there. There was no prosecuting attorney. The judge hardly even looked at me. There was no one else in the room. And the fact is, you plead guilty, you get 8 years. You plead not guilty, they find you guilty, and they give you 15 years.
So you were told all this. You were told all this.
Yes. Yes, by people, by prisoners, by the embassy. It's there's no way to get out of it. I was caught red-handed.
Did you have to call your parents?
Yes, eventually. And that was probably the hardest phone call to make.
And say, I've been caught smuggling cocaine.
Yep.
You were smuggling it into Venezuela, you were smuggling out of Venezuela, and where were you getting ready to fly to?
I picked it up in Venezuela, and I was flying to Amsterdam.
Oh, my God. And so now they open up the cans, and there's the coke. And how long from arrest to the time you were put in the prison that you stayed in?
Well, they put me in a detention center for about 2 weeks, which is down by the waterfront in Caracas. And it's very sweltering hot down there. But after 2 weeks, they take you up to the maximum security prison, which is up in the mountains. And that's an incredibly dangerous place. The guards are not... It's not like an American prison where the guards are inside watching everyone. Mm-hmm. They basically just stand around the outside of the building to make sure nobody leaves. And inside, the prisoners run the place. They've got guns, they've got hand grenades, they've got drugs, booze, prostitutes, everything you could want.
So it was pretty good time you were spending.
Well, statistically speaking, I would be safer being a soldier in Iraq than a prisoner in a Venezuelan prison.
So when we watch Locked Up, you're telling this story, and do they speak to the people back in Venezuela and ask them about the prison you were in, or do they? Is it what do you call it? Where they have the actors, the non-union actors doing the reenactment? You
know? No, they filmed it in Peru. They used a Peruvian prison to stand in for Venezuela. But mm-hmm. some of the exterior shots of the prison are actually there in Venezuela. I can't wait to talk to the producer and see if they actually went to Venezuela and, you know, on the QT took some pictures of the outside of the prison.
So you get in there, they throw you in a cell, and do you speak Spanish?
I didn't then. I can now, but nothing I can say on the air.
Okay, but, I mean, so you get thrown in. How many years did you do?
I did 18 months.
18 months. Okay, that doesn't sound...
Hey, you're lucky.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Well, considering that...
Hell, you'd do that in America, wouldn't you?
You get... well, yeah, you would do more time in America.
Yeah, well, you lucked out.
I don't really know.
Hey, who was the president of Venezuela when this happened?
Hugo Chavez.
Well, he seems to be pretty soft on crime.
Pretty nice fellow, yeah.
Yeah, he's a sweetheart.
How much it cost you to bribe your way out of this whole thing in 18 months?
Well, that's the thing. You could bribe your way out, but I heard stories of people spending, you know, $35,000, and they walk them down to the front gate, and just as they're about to walk out, they say, nope, we got your money, come on back in.
Right. Now, what about the sentence? Did you bribe it to get it down to 18 months?
No,
How the hell did you get 18 months? That's brilliant.
Well, America has a transfer treaty with most nations, and when they bring you back to America, the parole board looks at how much time you did, the closest equivalent of the crime here in America, and then they take into under consideration the treatment down there, the malnutrition, the violations of the human rights.
Mm-hmm. How was your cellmate, speaking of violation?
Well, now, see, that's the thing. It's not single cells. I was in a room that was about 20 feet wide.
That's a lot of violation, isn't it?
And 40 feet deep, and there were 40 of us in there.
Oh!
God forbid!
How about your turn in the barrel, huh?
Well, we had one toilet among 40 guys.
That wasn't what I was talking about.
So when you had to take a really bad dump, and there was another guy sitting on the pot, I mean...
Watching you and getting off to it.
What are you...
the food, the guys in the kitchen would steal the food and then sell it back to us. So we didn't get a lot of food.
How'd you make money? I probably shouldn't ask that, should I?
Yeah, how'd you make money in that prison?
Well, some people would do people's laundry. I got pretty handy with a needle and thread, sewing people's clothes.
I guess you don't fuck with the guy with the needle, do you, Jay? Honestly.
Oh, that's right. We're on Sirius Radio, aren't we?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
we can talk about the time they wrapped you in a blanket and you stabbed the guy in the eye with a needle.
Now, but wait a minute, though.
You stitched the guy's eyelid shut. Remember that time?
Well,
that was cool.
I'm looking at your picture, and you're a... You're a pretty man. You know what I'm saying?
Were you the prize in there?
Yeah, you're
pretty
man.
As a white American, I was the bottom rung of the ladder.
Bottom?
And everybody was out to get me. And
boy.
So
the fair-skinned.
One of the first things I did was I bought a guitar, and I started to play. And the big
Well, that certainly got, you know.
Well,
you bought a guitar? What kind of prison is this?
Did you
got a guitar center?
Did you sing, what is it, Shambhala? What is that?
La Bamba.
Kumbaya. La Bamba. Kumbaya? Did you sing Kumbaya?
No.
Or did you sing, Baby Bamba, Got Back?
Yeah.
If I have to sing La Bamba or Hotel California ever again, I'll just scream.
So were you violated there sexually?
Yeah.
No.
Did your guitar get tuned, as they say, in Venezuela?
What did you call it?
Your
guitar get tuned? Okay. Yeah. Any other Americans in the jail with you?
Any chicks?
Well, every Wednesday, Saturday, and Sunday, they would bring in prostitutes.
Nice.
And one fellow looked at me, pointed...
No wonder you're so calm about this. You're getting laid three times a week.
No. Believe me. One guy pulled me aside. He pointed at a girl. He said, hey, $10, have sex with her. And I said, no, you got to pay me more than that. They're not...
You know, that's a bit that you probably shouldn't use on other
shows. Yeah, you shouldn't use. Yeah, if I were you, I wouldn't, you know. Now, here's the other thing.
Let us do
the
humor.
Are you liable for more jail time once you get back in the United States?
Well, they said 33 months and 6 months off with good behavior, so it's 27 months, and I already did 18, so I did another 9 months here.
And so when you got back, you get thrown into what jail here? The federal prison in Atlanta?
No, I went through Houston. I was 2 weeks in the FTC Houston, 1 week in Oklahoma City. Oh, you guys don't know this, I bet. They fly you on a jet plane with your feet and hands and chains. And in Oklahoma City, the Bureau of Prisons jet pulls right up to the prison. You walk off the jetway and you're in the prison. It's amazing. Next time you're in Oklahoma City, look across the airfield and you'll see the prison out there.
Wow.
And then they took me to Miami for the remainder of that 8 months.
Now, the other thing is that you were like taking a vacation when you were going to, carry the coke and all that. And so you had a little vacation planned in Amsterdam, didn't you?
Well, actually, I was going over for a tour. I had
a two-month
tour, yeah. And I had all my musical equipment with me to going to Venezuela, and it all got stolen.
Did you write any tunes while you were in the Venezuelan?
Well, you know what? Stay away. We got to go away. Listen, we can't. There's not enough questions here. We don't want to ruin the show, but stay where you are. I mean, the National Geographic show. We'll come back with David Evans, who spent 18 months in a Venezuelan prison.
Get the guitar, David, and be ready.
You have a guitar?
Back,
we'd
okay?
love for you to sing.
Right here.
All right. He'll come back and sing some prison tunes, and you can call us at 888-4-102-102. Something in Spanish.
Coming
you know.
Around the bend.
And don't forget, tomorrow night, this incredible guest will be on Locked Up Season 3 tomorrow evening on the National Geographic Channel. It's the Jay Thomas Show with Rodney Lee Conover. Now, this guy says he's got his guitar ready to go. I don't think I want to hear him play. Let's see if we can figure out a way to keep asking him questions so we don't have to listen to his guitar.
In a post-apocalyptic world, two men, enemies from birth, armed with only uncontrollable rage, have sworn to destroy each other and rule the wasteland. Mel Gibson, Christian Bale, they are the Rage Warriors.
I have plenty of energy to drive over. You understand me? And I will!
What the fuck are you doing?
You make my life so fucking difficult.
Shut the fuck up.
Just fucking listen to me.
No, no.
The Rage Warriors.
What don't you get about it? Give me a fucking answer.
If you get raped by a pack of niggers, it'll be your fault.
Kick your fucking ass.
Get the fuck away from me.
What the fuck is it with you?
Fuck you. You make me want to smoke.
Oh, good for you. And how was it?
What?
You're unbelievable, man. You're unfucking believable.
What?
Gee, you got fucking something to say to the prick?
Just walk away.
What? You should just fucking smile and blow me.
I'm gonna fucking kick your fucking ass. You don't shut up for a second, all right?
The Rage Warriors. This film is not yet rated.
Jay Thomas, yes.
He's the afternoon guy.
Very perky.
Not like the rest of us.
The Jay Thomas Show.
On Indie, Sirius XM 104.
Now, if you have the cocaine in an aerosol can, what do? Do you spray it right in your nose? How do you get out of the can? That's what I want to know. David Evans carried cocaine in aerosol cans from Atlanta to Venezuela. Went to Venezuela from Atlanta. And then right when he was getting ready to get on the plane to Amsterdam, he was captured. And he will be on Locked Up Abroad Caracas as it premieres tomorrow night on National Geographic, 10 o'clock Eastern and Pacific. Funny thing that we're talking to you today. I happen to know Billy Hayes, the original guy from Midnight Express.
Right? Really?
Wow. He became like a movie producer, and I bought a movie from him. Scott Bakula did it. It became a movie called Bachelor's Baby on CBS. They don't even show it anymore. It was awful, absolutely awful. And I was proud enough to write the treatment and help produce it and everything else. But Billy Hayes, you know, spent 5 or 6 years in the Turkish prison, and all kind of stuff happened to him. Remember the scene where his girlfriend rubbed her nipple against the window? Remember that?
Who could forget it?
Yeah. And then, of course, in Cable Guy. Yeah, in Cable Guy, you know, Jim Carrey does the same thing. Now, your girlfriend was waiting for you in Amsterdam. Were you able to get a phone call to her and tell her that the vacation was postponed?
Yeah, I sure did. And she was stuck holding the bag with a, you know, 3 months worth of gigs and no guitar player to do it with her.
Oh, that's what she was worried about, her career?
Well, of course she was worried about me. The first thing she said was, I'll quit everything and I'll move to Venezuela and get a job just so I can see you. And I said,
wow. How easy was it to talk her out of that?
No, I told her no, she needed to keep the band
and
going.
She went, okay.
So I had a career when I come out.
Yeah, you're right.
Where is she today?
She, right now, she's in Florida. Now, funny thing, I'm on probation. And
is she with the guy that set you up now?
I'm sorry?
Is she with the guy that set you up?
No. No, but she's got jobs for me down in Florida, but my probation officer won't let me travel to Florida because I don't have a job.
Oh. Or because you're too, wait a minute, or because you're stupid?
Well, he says, oh, there's drugs in Miami.
When it hits 28 cell.
No, yeah, well, your IQ hits 28 cell. That was now, listen, when did this all go down and how long have you been out?
It went down May 2006.
Wow.
And I got transferred to America December 5th, 2007, mm-hmm. and I got out August 22nd, 2008.
This is like recent history. So this National Geographic crew, were they waiting for you as you got out? I mean, did your agent already call them and say, we've got a locked-up guy for you here?
They actually wanted to do it when I was still in the federal prison in Miami, but they wouldn't let the camera crew in.
Okay.
So they waited until I got out, and we filmed it back in November.
Dave of Vermont, the Jay Thomas Show. David Adams is here, was supposed to carry the coke and didn't turn anybody in. Yes, Dave of Vermont, go ahead.
It's Jay.
Oh, it's Jay of Vermont. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jay.
Yeah. Sounds like a party, Jay. The Venezuelan prison? Sounds
yeah.
like a party. How much
it's
is heroin down there?
Yeah, and they're selling stuff all the time. I'm like, where are these guys getting this money? Buy the prostitutes and the guitar. And
Dave, Jay of Vermont says it sounds like a party in the prison.
Well, if you can avoid the bullets flying around and the hand grenades and the machetes and all that, yeah, sure.
Well, you managed to, so it was a part of it.
David, were there really? David.
Yeah.
David.
Sounds awfully Hillary Clinton-ish. Just
David, now. The hand grenades. How many times did you throw a hand grenade?
You heard one, maybe, in the distance.
Several times. About 3 weeks before I left, one went off about 50 feet from my bed.
And it didn't kill you?
Scared the ever-living shit out of me.
But what about
right?
Yeah, but what about the shrapnel and everything else, you know?
Well, there was a wall between me and the hand grenade, but it blew a big hole in the floor.
But does it kill all kinds of people near it when it goes off?
Well, luckily nobody was near it. They love to shoot their guns and make a lot of noise. I actually thought, you know, gee, shouldn't they get silencers? And somebody said, no, if anything, they get amplifiers for their guns.
So there are no guards in the prison?
No guards in the prison, except when they bring in the drugs or the guns or the hand grenades or whatever.
Right. Is this all going to be on the television tomorrow night?
No, actually, the show only scratches the surface.
Right, hold on a minute. I always say that, don't I? I never did ask about the can. Was it in a Ready Whip can? Hairspray? What was it? Damn.
Are you feeling depressed? Are you feeling down? Don't take a pill. Just gather round and listen to The Jay Thomas Show.
I think we're all depressed. I really mean it. There is really something to be said the way you know, get over stuff. We work with Madison. She is positive that there is something wrong with her. I'm going to tell you now, there is absolutely nothing wrong with that woman. Have you seen these commercials where the people are really depressed and they take a pill and they feel better? How would you like to be? Have you ever been around a person who takes a pill to feel better? Have you ever met anybody on lithium? There's a frozen smile on their faces all the time. And if I get mentally weak, it's over. I mean it. Bullet to the head. See you later. If you're going to kill yourself or jump off a bridge or put a bag over your head or whatever, I don't know why I don't. I just don't feel sorry for you. Oh, is that selfish? Hell, I guess it is, but it sure is comforting.
Jay Thomas. The Jay Thomas Show.
It's the afternoon show.
Sirius XM 104.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Indeed.
Sirius XM 104.
We're all up. We're up. Ready's up. Up, 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 up. the Jay Thomas Show. Rodney Lee Conover is here. And welcome to the show. I had to rush off to New York over the weekend because for the last 10 years, my father-in-law has been dying. And he's been declared dead any number of times. And he never dies. And, you know, he's a nice enough guy and all, but, you know, this time it was pneumonia. And he wasn't going to make it. So we jump in the plane, and he made it. You know, at some point, you know, give us
Jay,
a break.
Stop it. Not funny.
At some point, you know.
Not funny.
Give us a break. Well,
that is so not funny.
He has lived a long and seated life. He just sits in a chair.
I you know what I smell?
What?
A little inheritance.
Well, there is a little inheritance, but the longer he lives,
the more the stock market.
Yeah, the more the stock market goes down and everything else. You don't want to say stuff like that.
You'd like to get it into a more stable.
Yeah.
By turn. Perhaps I mean, tax-free municipal bonds.
Yeah, I don't think he's investing it like I would be investing it. So
right.
And my wife does say, she goes, "Oh yeah." I go, "Is the money still there?" She goes, "Yeah, it's you know, it's still there." She sees it in the it's a couple hundred grand or something like that. But you know, he just says, so then they want to put him into a rehab facility, you know, to make him, you know, better or something like that. And he doesn't want to go in the rehab facility. And I was against it also. Because they're expensive.
Oh, man.
So they're all having this discussion.
Not funny.
My wife is going, Jay, say something. He doesn't want to go in the rehab facility. And I said, now, how much is that a month? And they said, well, it's like $5,000. I went, you know, I think.
And I did just see you going. Calculating, you know, how many times $5,000 divides into 300.
I think we can get some help, you know, at the house there for them, you know, something like that.
That's so no anyway. Place for a person to be. Get off of yourself.
Exactly.
What? You want your kids to do that to you? I'm not participating in this.
You don't want to die among strangers?
Yeah.
So that's what happened.
All right,
so
now you got me laughing at it. Let's move on.
Well, no, he's had a long and fruitful,
long, prosperous, and very
right. Baseball season has begun.
Cubs are 1-0, baby.
And Mike of Cleveland has sent me the top heckles for baseball players this year. I guess.
Oh, I want to hear that.
This comes from the Heckle Depot. The Heckle Depot, where you can actually go and things that you can...
Aisle 9 or knock-knock jokes?
You know, I guess so. So here's one. Here's the here's number 14. Come on, Cinderella, get to the ball. That's one to yell out. Do you have a baseball... Well, it's 14. You have to take me out to the ball game or something like that?
How about if I just do Harry Carey while you're doing it?
Hi. I would
Number
be
13.
Reverse if I didn't mention the Jay Thomas Show.
May I have your attention, please? I'd like to welcome everyone to my first annual backyard party.
That's right. The first annual everyone's invited, play lots of games, and have fun backyard party.
Eight, what's this?
Nine,
what's...
10, ready or not, here I come.
What's this?
We have a full day planned of playing and singing.
And food?
Oh, yeah, food.
And food.
What is this? What are you playing?
Come on. Careful there, Junior.
Why then?
Maybe we can start out with a nice, safe party song. Pa, you know a good one, don't you?
Oh, do I ever. Backyard parties are practically a national pastime. So follow my lead, everyone.
Oh, here we go. All right. Good. All right, here's another one. All right, ready?
Well, I used to play a little bull.
Hey, Dracula, wake up your bat. No good? Okay. All right. You've had fewer hits than Vanilla Ice. Bring it down.
Yeah, I got one.
Go ahead.
When your batting average hits 28, sell. Thank you.
How can you eat with those hands?
For the shame. For it. One, two,
I thought only horses slept standing up.
Okay. I got a new one.
You couldn't pitch a tent. These are the number. These are the big heckles.
I don't know.
You couldn't throw a party.
Damn.
Here's one. I don't even get this one. Ready? Take off your coat. You're inside.
Does
that mean anything? No. You've got less hits than an Amish website.
You can't go wrong.
All right, I'm keep going here. You couldn't save anything even at Walmart. That's for a relief pitcher.
Right.
Here's this one. I've seen better arms on a snake. And finally, you ready for this? Number one heckle. Ready? How's your Japanese? All right, bring the music.
Take me out to the back. All right.
It's on the way now. Okay, thank you.
Well, Jay, I think I can speak for the entire Sirius satellite audience when I say we should start over.
No. Actually, somebody sent me that.
And I know.
I
realize that.
Well, what I like to do is I like to, give them their props, right?
Well, Uncle Lou is 1-0, Garrett. 1-0.
Now, here's the strange thing.
And we have Jay Cutler.
Yeah, here's a strange thing.
I haven't been this excited about a white Bronco since O.J. was on the loose. Get it?
Yeah, I got it. So how many more games now? The
151. Is that correct, Garrett?
161.
I'm sorry. 161. I stand correct?
What I don't understand, and I never will understand it.
Never?
You know, basketball has, 80-something games? That's
82?
82 games. Football is 16 games, and then the championships and all that can be like 19, 20 games, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
If you had less games, a guy like me would be a baseball fan.
Jay?
But you can't get excited,
Jay,
161 times.
Jay?
What?
How many shows do you do a year?
Well, it's 52 weeks. It's, five shows a week, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Aren't you glad we're not applying the same standard to the Jay Thomas Show?
No, but it's not a sport. It's not like a thing where you have a win-loss, thank God, that you don't have a win-loss kind of a ratio going. You know what I'm saying?
I didn't say it was exactly like it. I just said, aren't you glad they don't apply the same standard? Gee, I mean, if Jay just did less shows, I'd be interested.
No, what I'm saying is this, is that when you're playing a game and you go like this, my team has won three in a row.
How many games should baseball play? 10?
I don't know how many, but it would be more interesting if you played a game or two a week or whatever. And
two
and
a week?
That would be it.
God, you ruin baseball.
Why do they have to have so many games?
They don't have to. They just do. That's the amount that they've chosen to maximize profit. Jay, what if you made so much per show? Would you try and do as many shows as humanly possible?
Well, yeah, but the other sports.
Are you with me on this?
I am with you on this.
Well, the other sports do this. Hockey does it. Basketball does it. Now, football doesn't do it because there's too many injuries. If you had 100 games,
you'd get killed, right?
You and I would be starting.
But 182 games, it never seems like too much to you.
No.
161 games.
That's what makes, when it gets down the line at the end, that's what makes it great. It's just such a struggle. It's a monumental marathon struggle to get to the playoffs. Not just, what would you have them play, 25 games? No one would be interested in baseball if it's 25 games. Because the thing about baseball is any team can beat any team on any day. So if you had like 20 games, probably the best teams are not going to get into the playoffs. Probably someone's going to luck out and you have crappy teams. It's like socialism.
Well, I have to tell you that for a guy like me, the first time I would begin looking, first time I look at baseball is right toward the end of the season.
Well, a lot of people do that, so there you go. That's your prerogative.
But everybody got all excited over opening day, and it's like, you know what it's like? It's like building an ocean, and they go, hey, we all spit today. And now we're all going to keep spitting. And in another few months, there'll be this puddle of water here. It's like, I'm more of a hose guy. Get a hose, fill up the thing. You know what I'm saying? I'm a hose guy. You know, you're more of a spit guy. That's all. I just, you know, thought I'd bring that up. Yeah, do you like the fact that it's 161 games? You think that's interesting?
Nah, not really.
No.
It's more of a, but as it's not a, it's more of a pastime. I think that's why it's called that, because
it's pastime.
You always know a game is on every day, and it's, you know, something just to watch, but it's not
sort of relaxed, right?
It's nothing like football where you're excited every Sunday, and
yeah, God forbid, we wouldn't
energy.
Want that.
Yeah.
We wouldn't want that.
Jay Cutler.
Yeah. By the way, Mel Kiper Jr., who I don't usually normally like, had said something pretty crazy the other day on ESPN, Rodney. He said they're acting like this guy, Jay Cutler, had taken his team to the playoffs. You know, I know he was a Pro Bowl or whatever it was.
Yeah.
But he said it made him ill what was happening, that he had to go and vomit.
Let me lay a little fact on you.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. The thing about Jay Cutler is not about Jay Cutler. It's about the Chicago Bears.
Mm-hmm.
The Chicago Bears, in my lifetime, have never had a good quarterback. Jim McMahon was an average quarterback that just happened to be playing for a team whose defense scored 14 to 21 points per game. Okay? Not since Sid Luckman, when I wasn't even born, have the Bears even had a competent quarterback. This is a quantum leap for the city of Chicago. And I'll tell you, last year, and this illustrates the point, last year Jay Cutler threw more yardage last year than any Bear quarterback in history. The Bears are one of the founding teams of the NFL. They've never had a quarterback ever that threw for as many yards as Jay Cutler did last year in one season. He's only 25. There's reason to get incredibly excited.
Okay.
So whoever you were reading, obviously.
No, Mel Kiper Jr. is on ESPN.
He obviously doesn't study all the teams. He's obviously just studying, like, East Coast teams or maybe whatever he's into.
No, what he meant was they made him try out to be a big deal. That's all.
Well, he's a Pro Bowler. What do you want?
I guess. I don't know. I don't
know. How many Pro Bowlers you got out there? Seriously.
Not many.
Yeah.
I'm happy for you. You like the 161 teams? You're all excited about this?
If we can beat the New Orleans Saints with Kyle Orton, how do you think we're going to do with Jay Cutler?
All right, you know what? I have to tell you, I can't say anything right now because our quarterback has a big birthmark on his face.
And, who is that?
What? He does. He has this huge...
Is it Mike Tyson?
No.
Drew Brees.
Drew Brees has this big birthmark on his face that, you know, with laser surgery, like, you know, my wife had a thing on her back, you know, and it was, a, you know, like a birthmark. So you go and you laser it and it's gone, right? I keep looking at the guy. He makes, like, you know, $15 million a year. I keep going, get that birthmark removed. I don't get it, you know.
People are afraid of surgery.
I guess so.
Unlike you and I, Jay.
We got mail at jthomas.com. This
you
comes
got
from
mail.
Michael Murdoch. The other day, I noticed they were selling a Chia Obama. It's an Obama Chia Pet.
I like that.
Will you be selling that at jthomas.com when you revamp it? Sean, have you seen this? You can get it apparently at Walgreens. But there's a problem, I guess, that stores in Tampa and Chicago say the ceramic plant figure is inappropriate for sale. And it'll continue to be sold on the internet, but not at Walgreens any longer. Sean, have you seen the Obama Chia Pet Obama?
No, but I know what I'm going to buy for birthday presents.
There you go. The racism part of it is, we've got some complaints from people that they thought it was racist.
Chia is racist?
No, it's the hair.
Okay,
but
I've had enough of this. We can't make fun of Obama because he's half black.
It's green.
That's over.
But the hair is green.
I don't give a shit. I'm tired of it. He's the president. We're going to make fun of him. End of story. Chia head.
David Smith has written us. I've been listening to your show on XM. I enjoy it. Enjoy everybody. I need some advice. I do not consider myself a writer by any stretch of the imagination. I would like you to keep that sentence in mind as I continue with this, okay? You ready? You got that in mind? I do not consider myself a writer by any stretch of the imagination. Recently, I've come up with an idea that I think would make a great TV show. When I tell my friends and family about this idea, many of them think it would be great. Now, I want to get it out there. The problem is I live in a small town in Pennsylvania. Gerardville, Pennsylvania. 2 hours north of Philly. I have no connections to anyone in show business. I don't know who to pitch this idea to. I don't even know where to start, and I'm writing to you as a veteran in the business to see if you can help me. How do I get it copyrighted? Who do I contact about this idea? I know you're a busy man. I'm not busy at all. And you may not have time to help me out, but I'm lost. I want to see if this show is good or not. Help me out, okay? Then David Smith. Now, David, I can't help you. I cannot help you. But you'd have to give me the idea first to see if it's really a good idea. And you haven't told me what the idea is. Ideas are simple. It's execution that's difficult, okay? Now, here's the best way for you to make money, and Rodney, I think you back me up on this.
Okay.
You give me the idea. I steal it. And I make the idea into a hit. And then you sue me. Rodney, what advice would you give him other than letting us steal the idea once he gives it to us?
That's pretty much his only option, because anything beyond that, you're just kidding yourself.
You know this movie, Mall Cop?
Paul Bart,
Mall
totally
Cop.
Totally stolen.
Well, I don't want to say that right out like that, but it is alleged that that script had been going around,
It had won film festivals, that script. It wasn't just going around. And not only that, mm-hmm. the screenplay.
Now, let me say this.
Was entered into.
It's a legend.
No, I'm telling you this for a fact, this part.
It's a legend.
The script itself was submitted to a film festival in mm-hmm. the actor's hometown that played Paul Blart. You know the guy. What's his name?
Kevin.
Yeah, Kevin. Kevin James. Actually...
Kevin James.
Kevin James actually awarded this guy a prize for this screenplay. A couple, three years ago. And the next thing you know...
They're saying that he stole it. Right. So, David Smith, send me the idea.
We'll get right on it.
I don't know anybody either. If I had people, we could send things that we have everything. Managers, agents, publicists. I got it all. It's difficult for all of us. Okay. So what you need to do is send it and hope that we think it's good and we steal it. Okay. But there's nobody you could, you know, it's sad, isn't it? It's like, you would think you could call someone or you could go to somebody or whatever, but there's really nobody, There's nobody that you can.
The only thing you can do is register it with the WGA. Even if you don't belong to the WGA, you can still do that. It's like mm-hmm. $20. Mm-hmm. But who cares?
Well, what are you going to do
if someone steals it? What are you going to do?
Well, no, if it's your idea.
Yeah.
Well, can't you say that you had it first and you copyrighted it and all that stuff?
Well, then the other guy says, I was thinking about it 10 years before that. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, okay. Well, that's what they do also. That's right.
Sure.
That's right. You know, I once made a deal for a NASCAR comic book, and the comic book was printed and everything else, and we got Mike Martin, you know, the famous race car driver, mm-hmm. NASCAR, mm-hmm. okay. He was in the, you know, I went to Charlotte, to the Lowe's Motor Speedway, and we put up a bunch of money, and it was going to be a NASCAR, a comic book, and it was printed and everything else, and then it was going to be a cartoon, right? So I signed what's called a, not a non-compete, but a non-disclosure. You weren't supposed to tell anything about it. So I hosted the Animation Awards at Fox, okay?
I wrote that.
You were there with me, that's right. And I go over there, and I see the guy from Fox, and I knew that this guy that I had invested in from North Carolina had met with this guy also.
Uh-oh.
And so I go up to the guy, and I say, hey, and I mention the guy in North Carolina, and I say, hey, I know you met with him, and I'm an investor in the NASCAR comic book and hopefully this NASCAR superhero. The guy stares at me and says, I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, God. Those are the words you don't want to hear.
I don't know what you're talking about.
That's also known as you're fucked.
I said, hey, no, you had the meeting with the guy, blah, blah, blah. He goes, maybe we did, but, you know, we had that idea 5 years ago.
Right.
I called the guy up, and I said, hey, I was at the Animation Awards, and guess what? Blah, blah, blah. Do you know that the guy tried to sue me? For What do you call it?
Alleging?
No.
Defamation?
No. Tried to sue me for telling somebody that he had the meeting with about the idea or whatever. He did have the meeting. And the guy at Fox said, we've had this idea. By the way, it never happened. And it should have happened. There should have been some, you know, what do you call it, NASCAR superhero by now. But there hasn't been. But it is a slippery slope out there. And then people will, and by the way, you can't ever send a script to anybody. Because can't read it.
You got to send it through a lawyer or an agent
can't read it.
Or a manager.
It really is amazing how things get done.
I'm sorry. Can I tell a story too? Just real quick.
Sure.
When I was at Fox, in fact, the same guy that did those animation awards, him and I went into Showtime and pitched a show about a behind-the-scenes look at someone making reality television. And this woman we pitched loved it. She went crazy. She said, oh, my God, this is perfect timing, blah, 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 blah. So she said, you know, told us a bunch of things to do, write it up, get the episodes, you know, flush out the characters, Scooby-Doo, la-di-da. So we're like, great. So we spent a lot of time on it. We really got a nice Bible out of it, you know, and we went back in. We, you know, set an appointment to go back in to, you know, to talk more about it. Oh, I'd say 2 weeks later, we go back in. I swear to you, Jay, we get back in there, and she is stone cold. She is as white as a ghost. And we start to talk about it, and she goes, you know, turns out we have something in development just like that.
That's right.
And we just stopped. We just were, and I said to her, well, how long have you known this? And she goes, oh, you know, we were talking about like a month ago. I said, well, the first time we came in to pitch it, why didn't you mention that? Oh, you know, slipped my mind. I mean, it was the most incredible ripoff that's ever happened to me.
And they
did that series. It's not Showtime. It was another company. I won't say who the company is. But they went on and did that series. It went for like 3 seasons.
Well, anyway, David, to answer your question, I'm sorry. You can send it. You can send the idea. You pray that we steal it. You pray that the idea goes. And then you sue.
And you pray that, and when you lose the lawsuit, just pray we throw your phone.
Jay Thomas.
The Jay Thomas Show.
It's the afternoon show.
Sirius XM 104.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Indeed.
Sirius XM 104.
If you've never teabagged a bull, that's what this is about. Teabagging a bull.
Say, everybody, haven't seen my balls? They're big and salty and brown. If you ever need a quick pick me up, just stick my balls in your mouth. Ooh, suck on my chocolate salted balls.
The late, great Isaac Hayes, who quit South Park because they made fun of Scientology? Something like that? And just think, you think Isaac Hayes is up in outer space right now with Chagron the Second or whatever it is? I don't know. But, hey, let's welcome Christine Camarillo. Go to OakdaleCowboyMuseum.com. Hi, Christine. How many testicles did you down over the weekend?
Oh, just a few.
Yeah. So the big testicle festival, my friend Kevin Meaney is here, and he likes a good testicle every now and again also.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So when was the dinner, what, a couple of weeks ago, something like that?
The dinner was March the 30th.
Wow. We've had you guys on before, and the poor, is it a calf's testicle or a, well, whose testicle is it this
year? It's a bull. It's a bull, a baby bull's testicle.
Well, we kind of use big bull testicles for this. Because
I like the baby
bull.
I'm not a pedophile, but you know, it's just that I think they're more tender, the baby bull.
Of course they are.
When you castrate the baby bull.
Yeah, they are. The baby bull's testicles are
tender.
A lot more tender.
Mm.
However, since we need so many balls for the testicle festival, we have to order these.
Did you just say, out of this Christy Camarillo little voice, did you just say balls just now?
Well, I kind of followed your lead from the song we were listening to.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a television show, and every time somebody says something, you follow them, then your parents tell you that. You know? All right. By the way, do not hand the phone to anybody else.
Uh-oh.
I want to have the interview with you.
Uh-oh.
I know you were going to hand it to one of the board members.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
Well, now he's going
to
feel
well,
terrible.
At the end of the interview, we'll talk to him. But yeah. But right now, now Oakdale Cowboy Museum .com. Where are you located?
That would be in Oakdale, Jay.
What state are we in? I don't even know where we are.
We're in California, and we're about 80 miles east of Yosemite National Park.
Oh.
And we are about 20 miles west of the town of Modesto, California.
Oh,
so we're
I'm
in
sorry.
California's fertile valley. We're a very
What are you doing lines now? You're starting to
farming community, a ranching community.
Mm-hmm. Now here's the thing. It's hard for me to imagine cowboys. You know, they catch the calf, they brand the calf, whatever, and then they castrate the calf. You know, the bull or the full bull. Who was the first person that you guys can find back there at the Oakdale Cowboy Museum who said, "Hey, why don't we fry a couple of them up and put salt and pepper on them and eat them?"
Well, you know, it's been going on for years.
I think they were gay when they did that, like, you know, like years ago, like out on the range, you know, a couple of guys, they see a bull and they cut his testicles off and they kind of like, "Hey, you want to eat him?" And, well, nobody's around.
You know, it starts as a joke.
Yeah.
I dare you to eat one of the bull's balls.
It's probably, and you think they got turned on by it or anything?
No.
No.
All right, that's sick. I'm sorry.
So. To me, it had to be way back when.
Like it's kind of like Brokeback Mountain, you know, kind of.
A 10-cent bet. It had to be one of these. And I just need, like, I bet you 10 cents you won't eat a bull's balls like that. I mean, do you have any of that information? Because it's an odd thing to eat. I've been hunting. We've shot things. But no one's ever sat around and said, "Hey, let's eat the deer's balls." You know what I'm saying? And now I hear Eric back there.
No,
Eric, you're on the board of directors of the Testicle Festival?
Yeah. Well, yes, sir.
Okay. What is the history of it? I mean, let's say Kevin, Eric, Christine, we're all out together, and we've been castrating.
And drinking.
And drinking, and we've been branding, and we're, you know, the fire's going, and
dark, and
the fire's going, and we've eaten some meat, or we've had some corn pone, or
I'm
whatever.
I'm just taking my chaps off.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Feeling a little randy.
Yeah. We're pulling baked potatoes out of his ass. That's where you keep them when you're on the range.
Sure.
We've got the coffee going and the whole thing. Who do you think, Eric, said, "Hey, why don't we fry up a couple of these bull balls?"
Well, I think it goes to what Kevin said about maybe a few cocktails involved and maybe a good dare. That's kind of my guess, and okay. I would imagine that the first ones were probably not as tasty as the ones that we serve.
No, because they probably didn't cook them first. Let me just put them in my mouth.
Exactly. You're picking out hairs and everything.
Yeah.
We do that for everybody now. That's
right, so we're plucking the hairs out. There's hair on the bull ball?
Yes. Do you get, where do you get them? Do they come frozen? Do they come in a package? Bull balls?
They come from a packing house in 5-gallon containers, and they're USDA approved. They are checked.
What are they? What kind of solution are they in?
I think it's just there's no solution. They're just cut.
They've got to be like in a pickle juice or something.
It's not a pickle juice.
Nothing.
No, I think it's just might be a water. And then when we get them, then we prepare them. We take the cover off, and then the inside part is what we cut up into little bite-sized pieces and tenderize. And then they're marinated. They're put with a dry rub, and then they're marinated overnight. And
so you're not eating a ball.
You're eating a piece of a ball.
I want to eat the ball. I want to eat two at a time.
Now, Eric, are you a cook? Are you a chef?
Yeah, I work in the prep crew, and I work with the guys doing it, getting it all ready. Yeah.
What do you season it with? Like, you get the 5-gallon thing of bull's balls.
We use like a Santa Maria dry rub. We put some garlic in there.
You know what?
A dry rub?
One weekend, I went out of town and
kind of.
I paid $100 for a Santa Maria dry rub.
Yeah.
You know, and after that, it was a
happy
was
ending.
That's right. So now, when you fry them up, does it just does it taste like liver, or is there a nut inside of the ball?
There's no nut, and unlike popular belief, there is no like that gum when you bite into it. There's no squish or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
It's got a consistency almost like a piece of chicken, and they taste like whatever they're breaded in. And so with this dry rub, that's pretty much what the taste is. Some people dip them in salsa. Some people like putting ranch dressing on them. Some people just eat them plain.
Wow. Now, Christy, did you ever see those Swanson's bull balls with honey mustard sauce on them? You can get those in the freezer thing. Now, Christy, are you a testicle eater? Do you enjoy them?
Yes, I am.
And do you
are they an aphrodisiac at all? Like well, Chinese, you'd have to ask a Chinaman, yeah.
Well, you know, for me it doesn't seem like that, but if you ask any of the guys, they think they are an aphrodisiac.
Yeah.
You go in the bathroom right there. Man, look at me. I got a big boner after eating all those bull balls.
You know what I put on it? Wait a second. I'd go right back to Kevin's act. We need to put some Jack sauce from Jack in the Box.
You can hold the Jack sauce.
That is a good idea. Maybe we'll ask him to be a co-sponsor next year.
By the way, Christine Camarillo. Eric, how do you say your last name, please?
It's Partenheimer.
Partenheimer.
His name was my name, too. Yeah. So now, does anyone get offended when you guys have the Testicle Festival? How long has it been going on, Christy?
She just stepped up to get the door. Sure. We've been doing this one here for about 10, 12 years, I think, something like that.
Yeah. Right. Anybody complain and say it besmirches our community or anything like that?
No. We've never had anything like that. It actually just keeps growing. It started off a fairly small gathering of people. And
probably
now we're
started off with just maybe two balls.
With two, and then we've kind of gone to four. And we just, you have to go in even increments, but yeah.
Next year, would you leave two seats at the table? Kevin, I'd like you to be my guest at next year's Testicle Festival.
I would love to be your guest at the Testicle.
At the Oakdale Rotary Club, who sponsors it, and the Oakdale Cowboy Museum in the lovely town of Oakdale, California.
And hey, Jay, if you'd like to, if you want to make a little barter here, we'll send you I had a ball at the Oakdale Testicle Festival t-shirt for one of your t-shirts.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Sure. Sean, can we arrange that? We'll get a testicle. I had a ball. Kevin, can Kevin get one, too?
Absolutely.
Of
them?
You know, and Jay, you and I can wear our real tight jeans and show our moose knuckles.
Yeah, we'll have a special table for you guys to wear that.
And the people go, wow, look at their moose knuckles. Jay, you know what a moose knuckle is?
I know what a moose knuckle is.
Oh, good for you.
But I don't have those. I don't have those. Only women have them. How much money did you raise with people downing testicles?
We think we're going to probably net out again this year at about $28,000.
Wow.
How much is that per ball?
Well, we serve 400 pounds of testicles.
Both testicles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We order 400 pounds and we get, it's almost a pound a person.
Hey, Eric, sometimes they serve things like in a, like a little bird's nest made of, potatoes. Would you ever make something that looks like a jock strap and serve them? You ever do something like that?
If that's something you guys would like, I'll come up with something for you.
I would like that.
Yeah, sure.
I would definitely like that.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Absolutely.
Well, listen, always fun. We've talked to you guys before. Thank you from the Testicle Festival, and we'll be there next year. And so did the economy hurt the annual Testicle Festival?
No, actually, it was better this year than it's been in the last few years. We weren't quite sure what to expect, but people like their balls.
Hey,
they sure do.
I recommend that you send some of those balls down to Washington.
Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah, somebody needs to go up there.
The old GOP could use some good old balls.
Christy Camarillo and Eric
Partenheimer.
All right. And he cooks them, she eats them. The Oakdale Cowboy Museum.com, the Testicle Festival. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
All right.
A lot of fun. Well, you will admit, Kevin, that our first guest then was not a good one. But since then, has it gotten better guest-wise?
Oh, God. You know, even though Bruce, I think we beat him up pretty good. And I think that was fun to, just for our own enjoyment.
Well, he needed to jump out there. Everybody else we've had.
Andrea was great.
Boom. Boom.
She came out of the box.
Yes.
The bull's testicles.
Fabulous. The girl was laughing.
Yeah.
You know.
Even with the baby bull. She loved that whole pedophile thing.
All of it.
That was
good. Serve it. Jack sauce.
Yeah.
Jock. We did all the
jokes.
Yeah. I don't. Any? Did we leave any jokes on the table before we go away?
Oh, I'm sure we did.
Well, okay.
I don't know, but yeah, I know you will. You're so quick on your seat.
Oh, I am. The Masters, by the way, is on channel 209 XM and Sirius. By the way, Garrett.
Okay, if you have the best of XM with Sirius.
Okay, then you'll see. And it's something really exciting has happened. The guy's 9 under.
Well, he bogeyed 17.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
Who, the guy that was?
Chad Campbell.
Chad Campbell.
Oh, my God.
You didn't send him a telegram, did you?
I did not. You know.
You probably go, telegram to Chad Pennington.
Joey
Sindelar. You're doing great. Jay Thomas.
When he missed the putt, Joey Sindelar said, oh, that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
All right. You know, it is weird to think about it. I mean, out of all the things you've ever done, have you ever looked at, like, any animal that was dead and said, you know, hey, got to wrap my lips around those balls? Uh-uh. Not on my watch.
The Jay Thomas Show. For idiots, by idiots. Stop idiot action. The Jay Thomas Show. He's the afternoon guy. On Indy. SiriusXM 104. And on the SiriusXM app for smartphones. Indy.
So Kevin Meaney was with me, and of course his marriage crashed and burned. Is it good luck when you start your marriage in a funeral home? It's the Jay Thomas Show. Is this our guest singing? I thought this was our guest singing this song.
This is Lion King.
Lion King, right, of course. Hi, the Jay Thomas Show. Kevin Meaney is here with us. And let's welcome Andrea Tabler. Is it Tabler or Tabler? How do you say it? Tabler?
Tabler, Jay.
Tabler. How are you, Andrea?
Yes, sir. I'm great.
It's Andrea. Andrea, Jay.
Andrea.
Yeah.
Go to DeWitt and Tabler.com. And Andrea, you are the owner of the Highline Circle of Life Center. Now, it's an all in one kind of a place, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Exactly. You got it.
Mm-hmm. So it's a now Kevin, listen to this. It's in Thornton, Colorado. What a lovely town Thornton is.
Well, it's pretty nice. It's just a little north of Denver.
Yes, I know.
I was just out in Denver. I was at the Comedy Works out there. It's a fine club.
That's a great place. It is.
Do you have a comedy club inside the Circle of Life?
No.
Well, that would
but
be
we
great.
Probably could. That would be. That could you be know? One. That's a new. I'm writing down ideas of what we can do here.
You know, a little comedy, you know, while you're, you know, bringing the casket through.
Now you started as a funeral director, is that right?
Yes. Yes, actually, my husband's the funeral director, but...
Does he have cold hands?
No.
Most people that I meet death are always have very, very cold hands.
He's one of the warm ones.
Okay.
But he's got a cold nose.
So when you were, before we get to the circle of the Highline Circle of Life Center, when you were dating... DeWitt, and he said he was a funeral director. You know, did it take a while for you to kind of warm up to that, to see that this is a man you're falling in love with and you would spend the rest of your life with a man that was dealing with dead bodies all the time and grief and stuff?
Well, at the time when I met Larry,
His name is Larry.
He was looking for a musician, which I actually am a musician.
Mm-hmm.
And when he called, left me a message and wanted to know if I could do music for one of his funerals that he had arranged, I thought, wonder who this guy is, because I'm pretty good at recognizing voices, and I had never heard his voice before. So I did the service. And I said, sure, I'd be glad to do that. So I did the service. And after that service, he asked me, he says, well, could I talk to you after the service? Because I needed to ask you something. And I thought, aha, here it comes. He's going to ask me for a date.
Mm-hmm.
So I was really excited and everything, because I thought one of these days I was going to meet somebody that I was working with at some time, or I was wondering if that would happen.
So anyway, attracted to him.
I was.
Yeah.
He was kind of cute.
Yeah, I'm sure he is.
One phone call, and then you're singing at the wedding, or the funeral, excuse me. You're at the funeral, and he had on the black suit with the little tie and the white shirt. And is he a tall man? Is Larry a big man?
he's about 5'7", so we're about the same height. And actually, mm-hmm. we were born in the same year, so that worked out. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that attracted me to him is he was one of the first guys that asked me to go on a date that had a job.
Well, okay. Even though it was a funeral director thing, it was...
Right. I thought, if this guy has a career, he's got a job, I'm set.
Cool.
For life.
Yeah.
And I'll probably get a free funeral.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's kind of thinking back on those beautiful memories. That was mm-hmm. kind of went through my mind, and it seems only like yesterday.
Where were you and Larry married?
In a funeral home back in Omaha, Nebraska.
Mm-hmm. So here you are, you fall in love. Now I thought maybe you're doing this for these economic times, you know. How long have you been married to Larry?
The end of this month, we're going to be married for 20 years.
Wow. All right, 20 years. Now, was it fun to be married in the funeral home, or did you do it as a... why would you do that 20 years ago?
Because we didn't have to pay for it.
So it was free.
Free of charge, yes.
So and everybody came to the funeral home, and you just had it like there in the chapel where you'd normally be burying people and stuff?
So instead of a casket, there were the husband and wife there.
That's right.
But with no casket. Did you use any of the flowers from the previous funerals?
No, we didn't. There hadn't been anything going on that day, so there wasn't anything, except we probably would have if there was.
Yeah.
I don't know. But anyway, I was calling people that morning and said, you know, Larry and I decided we're going to get married, and actually we're going to get married this evening, and we're going to have the wedding, you know, in the chapel. It was a beautiful old building, though. It looked like a great big old southern mansion.
Did you have to put the hearses in the back? I would not want to walk into a wedding, and there were, you know, a couple of hearses parked there, even though they weren't in use at the time. Did you hide the hearses somewhere?
Well, the way this building was set up, there was a big underground drive-in garage, mm-hmm. and that's where all the cars were stored. So really, there wasn't anything out.
Didn't see anything.
There were no caskets there.
No.
Okay. So there was no formaldehyde. Like,
no.
You know, down
no
there.
No odor of that or, you know.
No.
Okay.
No.
So now, this Highline Circle of Life Center, you now, it is a wedding chapel, it is a funeral home, it's a crematorium, and it's an embalming facility.
Yes, it is.
And so, have you always been this way, or is this an economic thing you've decided to do?
I think we did decide to do this because we thought that maybe people might want to have a facility where they could have everything at the same place.
Now, Kevin, would you get married at a funeral home, crematorium, embalming facility?
I think that would have been appropriate for you know, to get married. I think that's a great, I think maybe even for a bris, you know, to...
Your wedding was kind of a death sentence, wasn't it?
Yeah. It didn't work out. I mean, it worked out for 10 years, so I got 10,
right.
10 good years.
10 years out of it, right.
But I've always been fascinated with, you know, funerals and, you know, my first funeral, you know, it was my Uncle James. And, you know, just going up there and seeing that dead body, you know, and, you know, when you're like 7 or 8 years old, it kind of freaks you out. And then I had this... You know, when I was like 14 years old, I had worked at this country club, and the bartender says, if you're a pervert and you die, they'll know that you're a pervert because when you die, you'll have an erection.
Have you ever heard that, Andrea,
that
a pervert?
If, like, you know...
No, I haven't.
Isn't that a terrible thing to say?
Yeah, they said that to me. They said, you know, like, I guess they referred to me as a pervert.
I guess so.
And they go, when you die, everybody will know you're a pervert because you'll have an erection.
Oh, my.
And I was like, what? Like, God, what if I die and I have a boner? You know, they're going to know I'm a pervert. So, is that true? Can you ask Larry?
I don't have anything to
call him up. See if there's any boners down there in the embalming room.
Now, Andrea.
I'm sorry, Andrea.
Yes, by the way.
I feel sick and mental right now.
This man was once strip searched by the FBI, so we're dealing with him. Yeah. Not a well man anyway.
I had a potato in my ass.
Larry, have you ever found
a potato in any of the corpses' asses?
Now, here's the
I'm sorry.
Here's the question.
I'm going too far. Andrea, you're a very, very lovely woman. Go ahead. Conduct the interview.
I have to tell you, I've done a lot of interviews, and he's not our normal co-host, Andrea, so let me apologize.
I'm in the ha-ha seat.
Yeah. Now,
she's laughing like Robin Quivers.
Oh.
Now,
Oh,
now,
my
listen,
goodness.
Andrea.
Well, we do have a lot of, we do have a big sense of humor around here.
Well, you have to have a sense of humor.
Yeah, we do.
God, get look people at that corpse.
Coming in, yeah. getting in there. Now, have you, here's a crazy one. Have you married somebody and then, like, maybe within a 6-month period, you ended up burying one of the people? So they would have been married at the funeral home, and then 6 months later, one of them drops dead or one of them will. I mean, that's got to be odd.
We haven't.
Do you get like a?
We haven't been open that long. We've only been open since November.
Oh, so this is a brand new venture you're doing.
Yeah. That is correct.
Oh, that's
okay.
Great.
That is, how many weddings have you had since November?
We actually have had 3 weddings.
Oh, wow, that's good.
That's nice.
That's yes. good. It's wonderful.
I bet on Halloween you've had a couple of weddings there.
I think that's going to be a big day.
Yeah, that's going to be a big day.
It is.
In this crazy economy, you've got to think outside of the box,
literally,
Andrea Tabler and her husband, Larry. Go to DeWittandTabler.com, and if you live in the Denver area, in Thornton, Colorado, the Circle of Life, it's the Highline Circle of Life Center, where you can get married. There's a funeral home, there's a crematorium, and an embalming facility right there, and it sounds like it's a lot of fun.
How hot does it get into the crematorium?
1600 degrees.
16. Now, do you cook anything in there? Or?
No.
No. So you wouldn't like throw something in there to heat it up, like a.
No, I think it would be incinerated.
Like a hot pocket. You know?
We wouldn't. Yeah.
Do you still sing at the funerals and the weddings? Are you still the entertainment?
I do. You know, we're able to offer that to folks because sometimes people don't know who to call on, and we say, okay, we got the person right here for you if you want to use their facility.
What's the craziest song you've ever sung at a funeral?
Actually, it was the Darktown Strutters Ball.
How does that go?
I thought I got asked.
Right.
But you've heard it before. It's when you'll be down to get me in a taxi, honey.
You'd be down.
Could you sing just a little? Because Kevin's a Broadway star. He was in Hairspray.
In a taxi, honey. La da 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 da. That's the one.
You sang that at a funeral?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Were you smiling and having the time of your life?
I was. It was for one of the old musicians back in Omaha.
Yeah, a little baby died or something? No. That would be horrible, little baby funeral.
Well, yeah.
You'll be down. Da, 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 da. A little baby's dead. Hoo, hoo.
Oh,
that's crazy.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I know.
Andrea,
that's sick.
Andrea.
You ever see the baby coffins? They're little tiny coffins of little boxes.
Oh, they are. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Is this Jay?
Yeah, well, it is Jay, but my co-host has just gone way, way over the top.
I'm in the ha-ha seat. I'm cuckoo.
Yeah. Just been.
Yeah, we're all fascinated with funerals.
This is not the normal type,
you know.
Sure.
Well, you know, every time we go somewhere, my husband, people find out what he does for his career. Yeah. He's like the center of attention.
Oh, I bet.
What sort of questions do they ask him? I ask you, you know, one, was it odd for you to date him? But when he's the center of attention, what would they ask him about being a funeral director?
Oh, they just get into a lot of, like, they want to know all the details.
Yeah, the boners and stuff like
that.
Yeah,
they just, you know, I think they feel safe when they know that they're, you know, they're talking about somebody's career. And I think it's a safe feeling because they know that it's not actually happening right at that moment, but it gives them a chance to ask the questions they've always wanted to know.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's one. If you get somebody really huge, can they not fit in the crematorium door?
That is possible.
Yeah.
That is possible.
And do you have to
say it? Cut them up.
Chop them up. And throw them in there?
Well, that's kind of a difficult subject because we have had to deal with that type of situation, and I don't know.
Funny,
one
Andrea.
Of the things I probably don't want to get into at the moment.
Well, no, it's okay. I mean, because you need to cremate them, and so we just. Did that sound ever come? Have you ever been in the high? By the way, do you live right next to the Highline Circle of Life Center? And
I bet they live upstairs.
I wanted to, but the city wouldn't let us build our residence up here, so we live about 3 minutes from here.
Okay.
Oh. So we're on call all the time.
Yeah.
And
but Larry says it better be a good reason if they call him at 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Because he's dead asleep. I know. All right.
Ew.
Andrea, owner of Highline Circle of Life Center.
I'm coming out there.
Colorado, absolutely. You get married, and you ought to start giving a certificate that if you get married there, that later on in life, you get some sort of a deal if you decide to get buried there also.
That's right. We've decided to do that because we've had several requests.
Yeah.
Good.
Yes.
Well, you have been a delightful guest, and thank you very much.
You guys are great.
You are fantastic.
So much.
What a wonderful person. And you asked Larry about the erection thing, and give our executive producer, Sean Kelly, a call back.
Or email me at kevinmeany.com. You know, all the kids go
there. Okay. All right?
Thanks.
Andrea. Thank you so much. Well, what a lovely lady Andrea was.
Oh, my God. She was, like, so much fun. I had a ball with her.
You were saying boner and everything else. And, you know, never know how it's going to turn out.
Well, she was very receptive to that. You know, I could tell the minute we started talking to her that we were going to have a good rapport.
You could feel that.
I did. I felt it. I heard it in her voice. And I knew she wasn't afraid. And people that work in death.
Mm-hmm.
Have great senses of humor. You know, they really do.
I thought when you said boner that would be pretty much it for us.
No, no.
She absolutely loved it.
She laughed like a loon. You know?
Yeah, and you know, she started singing that little song.
Yeah.
And you started talking about the baby funeral.
The baby funerals,
and I thought, well, we're going to lose her now? No.
Yeah.
She was right there.
Because she has seen the little baby caskets. Oh, they're horrible.
You know what? God, I missed one. Has she ever made love in a coffin?
Oh,
God.
Well, that's where she would have been upset. Larry is, they're both 5'6", 5'7". You know, they would fit perfectly in a casket, you know?
She would have answered the question.
Yeah,
don't you hate that when you're too late?
Yeah.
You know? Maybe she'll call back with the boner answer, Sean.
Yeah.
And if she does, put her right in here immediately. Damn it, I never asked her if they did it in a coffin. As brilliant as I am, every now and again I slip up. It's the Jay Thomas Show. That's right.
The Jay Thomas Show. For idiots, by idiots. Non-stop idiot action. The Jay Thomas Show. He's the afternoon guy. On Indy. Sirius XM 104. And on the Sirius XM app for smartphones. Indy.